you go? Where did you come from, Cotton Eye Joe?
You're tuning in to the Raised by Rentals program. This podcast will contain strong language and spoilers for decades-old media properties.
Welcome, everybody. This is the podcast where we examine pop culture franchises of the VHS era, improv new stories, and run, always run, never jump, because the Vengabus is coming again! To imagine how we might improve our favorite movies, TV, and games. I'm Josh.
I'm Mike.
And we were raised by rentals. Mike! It's never too early to catch the bus to Spooky Town.
Indeed.
Unless it's the Vengabus. We already established you should run from the Vengabus.
Yes, don't jump. In spite of what the song tells you, never jump. Just run.
Oh, man. I'm excited for this episode, Mike. We are back for another two-parter. And I did not preemptively give this two-parter another one of my clever titles like the Late Night Double Feature Picture Show or the Trigger Warning Twin Bill. So we'll have to tack that on to the next episode when we do the follow-up. But this episode itself is a sequel to a double-parter, the first part of a sequel to a double-parter. And that is last year when we did our first entirely original two-part episode, sort of an improv challenge to each other to come up with the best original idea. You know, I came with hot garbage based on the dumpster fire meme, and you came with the absolute gold idea of the Vengabus of Death.
Based on the ridiculous song from the 1990s that we like to party.
We like to party.
So we're just around the corner.
See, we're already cracking ourselves up when we just started, because it is finally time for the Vengabus Returns.
Oh, and it's going to be a doozy. Because, so now let's just let the listeners know. First of all, if you hadn't listened to the first episode, there's going to be spoilers, so you might want to go back and listen to that, just so you kind of understand what the hell we're talking about in this one. But I had teased in a previous episode that I had an idea for the Return of the Vengabus. Now, it was just a nugget of an idea, but I was kind of toying with a concept. And then about, 2 weeks later, you just texted me. What exactly was it that you texted me, Josh? I'll let you share.
Yeah, you were talking about ideas for how to bring the Vengabus back, and I was kind of like struggling for ideas on maybe doing a follow-up to Hot Garbage, but we just started, you know, riffing a little bit on the Vengabus, and out of nowhere, I just said, Cotton Eye Joe will rise.
And it's funny because, like, I was high as shit when you sent that, so, like, I cackled my ass off. I thought it was hilarious, but I had no idea where it would fit in. Then, as we approached doing this episode, I was like, all right, I want to involve the idea of Cotton Eye Joe, because that's just really funny. And then once I read the lyrics to the song, I was like, this could easily be translated into horror. And I came up with a fun hook for it, and I've just been running with it. I had to stop myself like 6 times from writing a full script this time. I was like, no, it's got to be improv. But I will say the horrors that I put myself through while trying to come up with the concept, like flesh it out fully and start to write the pitch. I listened to both the Vengabus and Cotton Eye Joe on repeat for a fucking hour. So I definitely wanted to murder things by the time that was done. But also, the words stopped having meaning in my head. It was just like, like over and over. And then it was like, I was getting angrier every time I heard the Vengabus. So it was like, I was getting like just pissed. But it served its purpose, and I got a pitch out of it. Oh, we are back for the Vengabus of Death. Enter Cotton Eye Joe.
Oh, man. Okay, so just a little bit more backstory. We don't get into it because, again, if you're here and you're listening to this, you need to stop. If you haven't listened to the first part, go back into Season 2, Episode 52, The Vengabus of Death, The Late Night Double Feature Picture Show, Part 1. And, you know, side note, I realized after the fact that I had actually fucked up the title of the show because you pitched it to me as the Vengabus of Horror. You kept saying that in your text messages. You mentioned it in the episode, but for some reason, I just kept going with the Vengabus of Death. I didn't even realize it was the wrong word. I titled the episode, put it out, listened to it again, and then realized after all the editing and everything, then I realized, wait, you said horror. You didn't say death. Oops.
I think death works better anyway, so fuck it.
Oh, man. So, yeah, you know, you had this crazy idea that you had one night after, you know, partaking of the devil's lettuce.
And indeed.
Texted me in the middle of the night, woke me up where I was, like, cackling, laughing at, like, the Vengabus of Horror. And then, you know, we hatched this scheme to do this, like, ridiculous two-parter. You know, again, your story based on a late 90s party jam and, you know, and mine based on a dumb meme. And we did your episode first, and we had this really cool horror story where we took the mascot of the Six Flags amusement park franchise from the early 2000s, Mr. Six, you know, who dances to that ridiculous song, you know, and lures people onto the Vengabus or to a bus to take them to Six Flags. And we kind of mashed it up and, you know, made a kind of slasher character out of Mr. Six. We had a couple of, you know, teens or early 20 somethings and took them out to amusement park and slashed the shit out of them. So we had a lot of fun with that episode.
We pushed one through a fence where he chunkified.
Yeah, it was like getting squished with like a potato masher.
Yep. I forgot about that death, so when I re-listened, I was cackling.
Yeah, I was listening to it yesterday, too, trying to refresh my memory, and that was awesome. But also, there was one part where we took one of the girls, I think it was Janet, I forget, and we put her on the roller coaster, and then we just had the roller coaster go at, like, supersonic speed over and over again, and it was, like, this creating this, like, Doppler effect of, like, as she was like screaming in circles.
But she also hit her boyfriend on the track and he exploded like a watermelon.
Yeah, we described it as like she was on like the log ride where
yes!
she just gets doused in water but it's blood.
Covered in viscera and gore.
I had a ton of fun with the episode. I thought we did a pretty good job of coming up with some interesting characters, like kind of a weird twist on a slasher and just a really fun, you know, fake movie that we were both going on and on about how, God damn, I just wanted to watch this movie so bad. Like, I wish this was real, you know? Mm-hmm.
And I still do. Like, after re-listening to it, I'm like, fuck, I do wish that this was like a cheesy horror film that I could just put on and watch.
Yeah, absolutely. It would be so much fun. So, you know, when you floated the idea a couple of episodes ago, it might have been in the Skin Deep episode, you floated the idea like, hey, like, I got this idea, you know, to bring it back. And I instantly was like, fuck yeah, I don't care what the idea is. We're definitely doing that again.
Well, and that's the thing. Like, I mean, as much as we love doing improv, like you know, improving of existing IPs, it is always a lot of fun when we get to do one of these ones where it's just one of us makes up a story and we run with it. Because this is what we used to do back in the day when we were writing comic books. Like, we would just pitch ideas to each other and flesh these stories out and just crack ourselves up. And now we're just doing it so other people can listen, which is pretty awesome.
Absolutely. I think it's so fun. Plus, you know, we live like, what, 2,000 miles away from each other in like other states. And right. Part of the reason why I wanted to do the podcast in the first place and why I used to enjoy coming on to the Boogeyman's Closet, your other podcast, as a guest before we started this one, was it just gives me an opportunity to like hang out with my friends. Like, we're not sitting in the same room, but we're like hanging out and having a fun conversation for a while. And it just kind of, you know, kind of grew and grew. And yeah, very naturally went back to the conversations that we used to have years ago when we did live near each other and we'd get together and, you know, work on a comic book or something, that we would just stand in your kitchen smoking cigarettes and go, oh, I had this one idea and this idea and this idea. And we would just talk for hours about all these like insane ideas. Like, if we were actually able to capture all of those ideas, I mean, we would just have like stacks and stacks of novels and screenplays and comic books. I mean, it would just be ridiculous.
Well, you know, when I think back on it, I always picture two memes. The meme, I always forget his name, but the guy from It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, like in front of the board with all the connecting lines. I always picture that. And the one with Matthew McConaughey just like sucking down a cigarette, eyes all wide.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I was going to say, that's kind of how we were making those stories. It was like, holy shit, dude, if we do this, that connects to this. And oh my God, look at that. It's just fucking sucking down too much nicotine and drinking way too much caffeine.
Yeah, imagine just, you know, Matthew McConaughey looking at the dude from It's Always Sunny as he sucks that cigarette, just goes like, you know, you magnificent bastard.
Well, it was like, you know, again, not to derail us too much, but like when we were coming up with the sequel for Oopie, like I literally leapt out of bed and ran to my computer to write. And then we started talking and it spiraled. We created this whole insane sequel that connected to all of our superhero comic ideas. Like, I don't know how we connected a possessed teddy bear to superheroes, but we fucking did it, you know. So,
yeah, I mean, Oopie itself, and for the listeners who don't know, it's a graphic novel that we put together in the early 2000s, and, you know, we literally titled it Oopie, because I don't know what the fuck we were smoking at the time, but, you know, whatever. The story in and of itself between those two covers is wild. I mean, it goes in some really bizarre directions, and it came out of an original horror story idea that was supposed to be serious. In fact, it's pretty similar to what we did in our Trick or Treat sequel episode last Halloween, where one of the segments within our fictional sequel to Trick or Treat, you know, you had this like scarecrow monster, and I'm like, that's really similar to what Oopie was supposed to be when we first came up with it. And then, you know, like this weird like scarecrow slash corn monster, and then we're like, well, what if there was a possessed teddy bear, and like what if his like brain was exposed, and what if there was this like chicken who talked like he was in a blaxploitation flick, and what if there was this, you know, like this little kid who was always like hitting himself in the head, and like what, and it's like, what the hell? Like, there was so many like crazy ideas. And like, what if there was like literal biblical demons in it, you know?
The murder obsessed dog.
Oh God, yeah, I forgot about the murder obsessed dog. And there was just so many crazy ideas. And like, we've, you know, it's spoiler alert, it culminates with a guy who had previously been oblivious to everything in the story, like revealing himself to be a complete sociopath who creates a sculpture out of like dead bodies and props from horror movies for some reason.
Yep. And we literally end it. The last line in the book is, I like chalupas. So
it's so stupid. And we stole an entire monologue from a Kevin Smith movie. We even did an entire page where we just parodied It's the End of the World as We Know It by REM for no reason, just because.
I still can't sing the real words to that song. Like, I don't remember the real words. I remember our version. So anytime it comes on, I'm singing along in Twiggles speak. Like, it's terrible.
Oh, it was really dirty too. It was really dirty. You know, it was so like raunchy that it's a little bit uncomfortable for me now as like a 44-year-old parent. It's a little bit like we pushed the envelope a little much. So that comic book is just insane. But yeah, we had this crazy sequel. We put a bunch of work into it. You know, unfortunately it never came to fruition, but you know, here we are again on the podcast to kind of bring it back, where now instead of having to spend literal years writing and drawing and inking and shading and, you know, coloring or whatever these comic books, instead it's like, you know what, let's just spend like 2 hours recording a crazy ass story and then we'll do it again.
Yep. Which, you know, and that's the thing, that the fun is making the story. Like, I think as much as I love to draw, and as much as you love to draw, and we both love to write, like the drawing process is so fucking long. It's so much more fun to just try to like tell the story, get the story out. Like I always said the same thing. If we had the money to hire artists to draw all the ideas that we had, it would be like, oh, we would have made so many damn comic books, but the two of us did not have the time to draw all that shit.
Oh no, it takes forever. Even the writing of the scripts, you know, the script writing is probably the least time consuming of the actual work that you put into it, like after the brainstorming, and even that like takes a long time. But absolutely, like if we had the money, we would have just started like a story farm, and we would have just stood in the middle of a room going, okay, here's the idea, and just told people, you know, and then like you write this, like a bullpen, like you write the script, and like, okay, you start penciling and you start inking, and like literally it would have been like a factory of just spitting out ideas. And you know, we would have put out more comics than like any other company in the industry with all the ridiculous ideas that we came up with. Is, you know, not to pat ourselves on the back too much, but you know, we had a lot of ideas, and I still think that we do have a lot. So Mm-hmm. With that in mind, why the fuck are we going to tell a story about Cotton Eye Joe?
Well, for those that have never actually taken the time to look at the lyrics for Cotton Eye Joe, so now there's the majority of the song is literally just on repeat. If it hadn't been for Cotton Eye Joe, I'd been married a long time ago. Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from? Cotton Eye Joe. That's repeated like 8 times. But there's a line that says he came into town like a midwinter storm. He rode through the fields so handsome and strong. His eyes was his tools and his smile was his gun. But all he had come was for having some fun. Now, obviously, that sounds very sexual, but let's turn it creepy for a moment, because the next time it says he brought disaster wherever he went. The hearts of the girls was to hell broken scent. They all ran away so nobody would know and left only men because of Cotton Eye Joe. Now, again, I get it. I get what they're saying there. He's coming into town. He's screwing all the ladies. All the men are sad. All the girlfriends ran off on him. I get it. But that to me sounds like some crazy fucking sociopath coming into town and murdering people.
Yeah. Fuck yeah, dude. I don't think I ever even thought about that before. Yeah. I don't know what the lyrics to this song are. And, you know, if anyone just listening hasn't heard this song, and I don't know why you wouldn't have at this point, because it was such a giant, like, one hit wonder all the way back in 1994. And I still see kids watching it, like, on YouTube and shit, you know, fucking the Rednecks, which is, you know, side note, it's an insane idea for a band, or I don't know who these people were. This, like, Swedish, like, techno country pop band. I don't know what their fucking deal was, or, you know, why they called themselves the Rednecks. It was like, you know, Southern American stereotype cosplay.
Well, and the best part was they weren't even the ones, like, the band wasn't even the Rednecks that we see in the video and, like, in all the promotional material. Those were people that they hired to play the Rednecks. So the actual Rednecks were just, like, a couple of people, like, electronic musicians.
Yeah, it's so crazy.
It's bizarre. But yeah, like, it's, and we know that there are deeper connotations to the song and its origins. We're not going to go into that. We're taking it at face value completely. But like I said, you know, when you mentioned that, I had to figure out how to work in Cotton Eye Joe. Once I read the lyrics, I instantly had it. And it was like, oh, fuck, this is going to be fun. So now, do we want to just dive in, or do we want any more preamble?
No, I think we should just dive in. Yeah, I mean, again, go back, listen to the last episode of the Vengabus of Death, and, you know, get the backstory there. But, you know, the quick version is there was this guy named Danny who was a bus driver at the Darien Lake Amusement Park. He drove bus number 6, which became 666, and was driven, like, completely bonkers by having to listen to the fucking Vengabus, you know, It's Time to Party song over and over and over again until he went nuts and, like, killed a busload of people. And then years later was, like, a ghost or something, like, haunting this amusement park, which had been shut down. These 5 kids, or, you know, young adults, break in trying to have, like, a fun, you know, prank Halloween date evening. And they all get brutally murdered by the spirit of Mr. Six and his Vengabus. And we left it with a little bit of a stinger where there was, like, some other people who noticed that the amusement park, which had been shut down for years, was for some reason, you know, had all the lights on and was playing music and shit. And it was like, you know, fade to black from there after we brutally murdered these 5 people.
Well, and that's, well, actually, wait, how many did we get? Because we got the 5 kids and then we got 2 cops. So we got a grand total of 7 deaths in the first one.
That's right. We forgot about the cops.
So now we had 4 kids walking toward the park. So in the grandiose tradition of 80s horror sequels, we are literally picking up right where we left off. We're not going to be like, you know, 2 years later, 3 years. No, this is that fucking night. You know, boom, cold opening. We open. We see the 4 kids hopping the fence into the park that night. So. Okay. Have them, like, you know, looking around, like, what the fuck was all, like, what was the music? What was going on here? And as they walk in, they notice that the roller coaster has been, you know, mostly tipped over toward the lake. Mm-hmm. And it's like, holy shit, look at that. They all go running over, and now they start to see the gore and viscera, like, all the blood and gut. And they're like, what is this? Have one of them pick up, like, a piece of the, like, broken track, like the wooden track, and start just kind of like poking at the rubble to see if they can kind of uncover more of the gore. And then out of fucking nowhere, the Vengabus flies by, murders all of them, blood hits the screen. It rolls down, creating the title card, The Return of the Vengabus of Death. And then a branding iron brands the screen with Enter Cotton Eye Joe.
Okay, yeah, that's a great way to start. Just brutally murder all of these characters in the first 2 minutes.
We gotta up the ante, death count instant.
No, I love it. And you're right. It also goes right along of the grand tradition of, you know, 80s horror and action movie sequels where somebody lives at the very end and you think, oh, okay, like there's hope for, you know, someone to get out of this alive. And then they just murder them in the first scene or fuck off screen. Like, look, think about Alien 3. Like they killed, yes, you know, two of the survivors that you were rooting for. They killed them off screen before the movie even started.
Right. And then the third one is dying in a garbage pile. It's like, oh, poor Bishop. But but no, like I was, that's what was cracking me up so much, is because we did that all the time in 80s horror movies where like we would see somebody survive and then the very next movie they were either killed off screen, we find out how they were killed, or they're killed in the first 10 minutes of the movie. And it's like what was it? Friday the 13th, was it 2? That opened,
yeah,
that
part
way?
2. Yeah, they kill, yeah, what's her face, Alice from the first one.
Yeah, and like it just like we don't even know that there's we don't even know anything about Jason yet other than the dream sequence, and then suddenly there's a man in her apartment stabbing her in the head with a screwdriver. It's like, what the fuck? So but that happened all the time. But I love the idea of the cartoonish blood hitting the screen and rolling down to create the title card as the plays.
Then the music would just start slowing down and slowing down and slowing down. And then it would, like, you know, fade into whatever our opening sequence is.
Right. So now for the opening sequence, and this is where, like I did say, I wrote, like I was writing a script. So I'm going to try to speed through this without taking too much time. But the way I pictured the movie opening is like, so we get that cold opening and then we transition to the credits montage. So we would get the opening credits, but it would be like black screen with credits rolling onto the screen and then cutting back to the film. And what I'm picturing is like, picture, remember like the opening of Nightmare on Elm Street where we see Freddy making the glove in his garage?
Mm-hmm, for sure.
So picture that kind of like dilapidated, just grungy workspace and like a little color TV, you know, kind of sitting on a counter while somebody is doing something off screen. So we see on the screen reporters, police, everybody at Darien Lake talking about, like, you know, the reporter saying something like, early reports cannot confirm the death toll due to the grisly nature in which the bodies have been left, you know, something like along those lines. And then interviewing a cop being like, we haven't seen something this bad since the Mr. Six murders 20 years ago. But while that's happening, we're cutting back and forth and we see like a shadowy figure sharpening a knife and we can hear someone like muffled cries off camera. So eventually, okay, we cut back and forth. We see the blade like finish getting sharpened and like it get held up so we can see somewhat of a reflection of the killer, but we can't see, you know, totally, but we see that he has one blind white eye.
Okay.
In the reflection. So, you know, they're talking about the grisly murders on the TV. He turns, we see a woman bound and gagged, like in the garage, like looking terrified. And then we'll see a close up of the guy, like hold his finger up to his mouth and just go, shh. And before you know it, you see the shadow come at her. That's all going to be done in shadow. So no, like, mm-hmm, you know, grisly gore, but have him stab her in the chest. You see blood spatter onto the ground, have him reach into the wound and pull out her heart. So pull out her still beating heart.
Nice.
Then, now this is where it gets fucked up. He keeps it like a trophy, puts it in a fucking jar and puts it in a bag, slings it over his shoulder, opens the garage door and walks out. Now we're going to pan back over to the corpse of the woman. Her eyes are going to be rolled back in her head, so they're bright white. Big old hole in her chest. And now we're going to do that early 2000s thing where we zoom really fast in on the wound and the screen's going to go black, but we're going to hear the ghostly scream. So like, yeah, like as it zooms in.
Perfect.
And then smash cut to the high school from the first movie. And this is where we're going to, this is the part that I had the original idea for, is why we're doing this again. So we're going to see, like, we'll hear the bell ring. We'll see all these kids come running out of their class. we focus in on one young girl. This is Monica. That's the only character that I have a name for.
Monica, okay.
We see her walking out, looking kind of like distraught and upset, you know, just walking forward. Everything's kind of in slow-mo. Then it kind of speeds back up as her best friend, who I don't know what we want to call her. Let's just say Tanya. So okay. Tanya and Monica. So we'll have Tanya run up and just kind of, I want her to be that like really excitable, like friend. Everyone knows that one person who have like, they feel like they've always had too much coffee.
Yeah.
Even if they've had no coffee. Like, I want her to be that type of like super hyper, you know, ADD kind of friend.
Absolutely. Yeah.
But have her run up, be like, oh my God, bitch, how are you? I haven't found you all day. What the fuck are you doing? How are you doing? Like, just total spastic. Because we're going to find out that Monica was, wait, hold on, I wrote it down. Shit, where is it? I'm forgetting the names from the first one. Monica was Tanner's sister.
Oh, okay, Tanner's sister, so, yeah.
So she lost both her father and her brother in one fell swoop. So obviously, right, she's going to be pretty fucked up. So this can be like a couple weeks after the event. So, like, you know, she would be back to school, like her bereavement period would be over, you know, but obviously still going to be pretty fucked up. Right. Like, you know, you lose your dad and your brother to a fucking unsolved murder case. You ain't going to be right with the world.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know me, I'm always looking for opportunities to do like expository dialogue. So we kind of like have characters explain stuff in, you know, like casual speech. So, yeah, I love this idea, this sort of hyper over-caffeinated best friend runs up and exactly like you said, like, oh, you know, what the hell, like, where you been? And at one point during this whole thing, she's going to notice that Monica is, you know, looking a little bit bummed or whatever. And she's going to stop and like, oh, honey, I'm so sorry. Like, you know, I forgot. I know it's only been like a couple of weeks, you know, since, you know, your brother and your dad, like, oh, how are you holding up or whatever, you know, just kind of like introduce some of that,
right,
that storytelling for the audience.
Yeah, we could have her be like, you know, like, how are you holding up? And have her be like, well, you know, as best as I can. Her be like, all right, what can I do to cheer you up? You want to get coffee? How about some coffee? Ooh, what about boba? Bubbity bubbity boba. Want boba? Like, yeah. Just like, that's her personality. Like, just a squirrel made human.
Yeah, that's a good description.
But I want him to have, like, I'm thinking, okay, so the first time we had five friends. So this time we should have, at least have six or seven. Like, we need to up the body count. So, let's just do six. We'll have three girls, three boys. Sound good?
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. And I don't know why I'm thinking about this, but thinking about this high school and thinking about this hyper friend, I just immediately started thinking of like the cast of Scream and, you know, kind of like that whole vibe. What was the girl who gets like crushed in the garage door? What was her character's name? It was, you know, something like Piper or Harper or something like that.
Oh my God, what the fuck? Because that was Rose McGowan. Oh my God, it's right on the tip of my tongue. Fuck. I'm like, there's Sydney, there's Gail Weathers, there's Casey who gets murdered early on.
Tatum.
That's Tatum.
Tatum.
Yes, yeah, Tatum, you're right.
I have to
look it up. Because I'm sitting here going, okay, there's Billy, there's Stu. I'm like naming everybody but her.
No Billies. We can't use Billies.
Yeah, no Billies. Well, and it's funny because like Monica was the first name that came to my mind when I was first writing this. And then I started giggling to myself and referring to the others as like the rest of the Friends cast. And I'm like, no, yeah. I'm not doing that.
Yeah. Fucking Chandler and Joey. No, but we could do, you know, we could kind of take that joke and like, you know, Monica was played by Courtney Cox, right? Mm-hmm. In Scream. And since I mentioned it, like, we need some more names, and we always like seem to struggle for names that aren't like, you know, Billy and Mike and Sam. So let's just write a couple names down. So I'm writing down Rose because we had Rose McGowan.
Okay.
And
so that could be the third lady.
Yeah. And then we had what's his name? Matthew Lillard. So let's go with someone named Matt, maybe. And who else is in that movie? Like, Skeet Ulrich, is that his name? Sorry.
Yeah, we can't do Skeet because the whole time I'll be going Skeet, Skeet, Skeet. Like, I'm not gonna be able to stop myself. From the window. No. Sorry.
To the walls.
Oh shit.
Yeah, so there's Rose McGowan. I had to look it up here. David Arquette. We can't go with Nev Campbell. We got Matthew Lillard. I mentioned that. And then Drew Barrymore. So, yeah. So, we already have Monica and Tanya. Let's go with a Rose, whoever that's going to be. Let's go with a David. How about that? And then I mentioned Matt and Drew Barrymore. That's not a dude, but it can be in our story. So yeah. let's have an Andrew who goes by Drew. Yeah. Okay. So there he goes. Just to get the names out of the way so we can just focus on the characters.
Yep. And I mean, obviously, Monica would be our focal point character because she is our connection to the first movie. So, yeah. So like we'll meet the cast of Friends. Right. So we meet Tanya. She comes running up to Monica kind of like very hyper, but like she has good intentions, but maybe not the most socially conscious. Like, you know, like, oh, you just lost family members. Want some boba tea? Like, you know, she's that type of friend.
But she's also just like endlessly like positive and bubbly all the time. And, you know, it's, sometimes you need that to kind of like cheer you up, break you out of a funk.
Absolutely. And that's the thing. It's like it's that friend that is hyper, but not trying to be insensitive. They're just really hyper, and that's how they show they love you. So that's kind of her character, which, again, I know plenty of people like that, and I love a lot of people like that. So it's like when I was thinking about this type of like downer opening, I'm like, yeah, that would cheer me up, you know, to have one of my friends being like that. So So we're going to introduce, I don't know how much we want to go into it, but like we'll introduce the other characters. Maybe they all, you know, sit outside for lunch and are just kind of discussing, and we can have them just do some more of that exposition dialogue where they're talking about the mystery surrounding everything that happened. And, you know, maybe Monica's the one to bring it up because they're like, or no, we'll have like, maybe like David says something like, so did the police ever figure out what happened? And have Tanya be like, dude, shut the fuck up. We're not talking about that today. And have Monica be like, no, I want to talk about it. Like, I need to talk about it, and have her express like what she knows. So like, she could basically be like, you know, the police don't really know anything. Like, we have no leads on how this happened, what happened, but, you know, they closed they basically blocked off the entire park, like put up a new fence and, you know, a bunch of do not cross, you know, police line and all that. And you know, maybe she even makes a comment of like, you know, some reporters are going to get rich off of this story. Like, you know, unsolved murder mysteries always tend to, you know, keep getting brought up in the news again and again. So it could be one of those things where it's like, you know, she's a little jaded by what's happening to the circus that has become the death of her family. So eventually what I want this to lead to is they're going to want to go full Scooby Gang and figure this out.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Okay, so I don't know how much you had planned out who these characters are going to be individually, and I know you said you had so many ideas and were trying not to write it all out ahead of time so we can kind of improv, you know. So again, just like we did with the names, before we get too far, let's establish a couple of like personality traits for these characters. I think it'll help as we go to differentiate, you know, Monica and Tanya and like the other four. Like, it'll help to kind of like, you know, cement who the characters are.
Oh, yeah.
Differentiate between the other four of them, and hopefully help the audience, like, you know, care a little bit. But also it could help with some storytelling decisions as we go along. Like, what are the characters going to do? Because what I don't want is just, you know, a very plot driven horror story where you just get like six random, you know, pretty actors who just stand around going, whoa, what was that? And then they get killed. You know what I mean? Like,
yep. Well, the first thing I thought of is Rose should be like the snarky goth chick. You know, because again, we're talking a horror movie. There's always the goth chick.
So I had an idea for one of the dudes, and I think it kind of goes in with Rose being the goth chick. So I'm just gonna pick Drew. So I think Drew should be fascinated with like the bloody details. Like, he doesn't want to say anything to Monica, but he's like asking kind of leading questions, like, so like, you know, what happened? Like, you know, did you have to like identify the bodies? Like, what did they look like? You know, he really wants the bloody, gory details. And maybe he's like into serial killers and stuff, but like, he's kind of embarrassed to just come out and ask her because obviously she's mourning and those were like your family members. But he really wants to see like the crime scene photos, you know?
he's like one of those true crime fanatics that takes it a bit too far.
Yeah, exactly. And so in the interest of like flipping stereotypes a little bit, you know, with Rose as like the goth chick, and we do like snarky goth chicks in a couple of our stories. So let's have it that she's the goth chick, but she's absolutely like can't stand the sight of blood, gets really freaked out and scared really easily. Like, so she's into goth because she likes the music and like the vibes and all this, and like maybe she loves horror movies, but like as soon as somebody like accidentally gets like a paper cut and there's like a drop of blood, she's gonna faint. Like, she can't handle it.
She could even be one of those, like, what are they, the kawaii goth chicks, mm-hmm. where they're like all into like the bubbly stuff, but they still like the dark aesthetic. Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. It's basically like modern Hot Topic, where you go into Hot Topic and it's like it's like goth stuff, but it's like, oh look, it's a cute little like, you know, Hello Kitty backpack.
Like, yeah, stuff exactly. Like that. Yeah, so she's the cutesy goth, but yeah, again, yes. I think it'll help us in a storytelling if like she can't stand the sight of blood, so like there's gonna be situations where she's like useless, you know.
Oh, absolutely. Okay, yeah, I like that. So let's see, we got Matt and David left to figure out, because Tanya's the bubbly excitable one, Monica's basically the final girl / lead character type person. She's that archetype. Yeah. Sure. So we got Matt and David. I mean, in true horror fashion, we kind of need a meathead, or at least a jock of. He doesn't have to be a meathead. Maybe jock of some kind. We could even do the cabin in the woods stereotype and have the jock actually be really smart.
Yeah. Okay. I like that. Let's have like the meathead jock guy. He's actually really smart. Let's have it be that he's like the editor of like the school paper. Like, that's his contrast. Like, he's both the head of like the football team, captain of the football team, and he's the editor of like the school paper. He's into like journalism and stuff. So like, he really loves all the attention that is around Monica. But again, it's like kind of like how Drew doesn't want to like be too insensitive with like the gory details. Matt's trying not to be too insensitive, but he like loves it that there's like reporters and cameras and shit around. And of course, you know, in the age of social media, you know, he's got to be like a TikTok guy.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And keep in mind, this does take place present day, which even though this is something that we've avoided with all of our other stories, the Vengabus was present day. So this is going to be, and this is only a couple weeks after, like at this point in the story, this is only a couple weeks after the first movie. So we would probably be like, what, early November at this point? Because it was like mid-October, somewhere around there. So.
Yeah, because Tanner and Jasper were trying to take the Clarkson sisters out to the amusement park for like a Halloween date. So, yeah, this would be sometime after Halloween, you know, before Thanksgiving. But, you know, you make a good point, and you know, that there are going to be cell phones around. So we need to deal with that in some way.
Right. And then we just have David. So maybe do we want to do the strong silent type, you know, the guy that. Because we already got the jock, so we don't need another strong dude.
Sorry for, like, you know, kind of dominating this topic, but...
No, go for it.
Let's do, like, the friend-zoned, like, guy who really crushes on Monica, but he's, like, way too much of, like, a nice guy. You know what I mean? Like, he's dweeby. He's a dweeby nice guy. You know what I mean?
Yep. Okay, I'm writing that down. And he's crushing on Monica.
Yep. So we've got, you know, Monica, obviously, she's our main character related to victims from the first movie. Tanya's the super bubbly, like, ADHD, crazy, hyper best friend. Rose is our, like, you know, cutesy goth chick who can't stand the sight of blood. David is the, like, dweeby, nice guy, friend-zoned who crushes on Monica. Matt is, like, our... he's like the overachiever. He's the football player. He's the editor. He's like on TikTok. You know, he wants to be like the local news anchor man. You know, he's that guy. And then Drew is like secretly fascinated by all the gory details, and he's into like serial killers and stuff. But like, he's trying to keep it under wraps so nobody thinks he's a freak.
he's the weird kid pretending to be cool.
yeah, exactly. And he's got to dress the most vanilla. He's got like a polo and like khakis on, because it's like a costume to like look normal, you know.
just like the serial killers he's obsessed with.
Exactly.
And it's funny because that is going to work so well in our favor. I'm so glad you came up with that idea. So we're going to meet all of these characters at like a lunch scene. I'm almost picturing the scene from Scream where they're all sitting around talking about how Casey got killed. And like, they're all kind of telling the different stories. And then, you know, Rose McGowan's character is like, Dick, shut up, like that whole thing. you know, so yeah, we'll hear about like the about what Monica knows. And it's not much. Like, she just knows that her brother and her dad, you know, were killed by something or someone. That, you know, even the police aren't sure. It's an unsolved case at the moment. You know, and just basically maybe she could talk about, like, how, you know, how bad her mom has taken it. Like, just it's been a really rough time at home.
Absolutely.
And of course, all of her friends are like, oh, we're here for you. Well, you know, whatever you need, blah, blah, blah. You know, we'll establish that early. So when she comes up with the Scooby gang, I want to solve the mystery idea. They're like, OK, let's go along with it.
Yeah. And you mentioned the mom, and that immediately made me think of, like, parents in horror movies in general. And I think just 80s movies, like, either parents weren't really around much, mm-hmm. or if they are, they're always like, OK, kids, go have fun. Like, having no idea that their kids are off on some, like, dangerous adventure, you know.
It's one of the trope list items of parents are stupid, where it's the parents are never aware of what's going on with their kids, or they give the absolute worst advice. It's like in Nightmare on Elm Street, when, you know, everything is pointing to children dying in their sleep and every parent is trying to say, go to sleep.
Yeah, exactly. So
it's the parents are stupid trope.
Yeah, parents are always stupid and clueless. And if they're not, in the rare exceptions where you get a parent who is, like, clued in, that's always the parent who's just, like, one of the gang and who's, like, really, like, immature. And then the other adults just think that parent is, you know, like I said, like, immature and stupid. And I'm just thinking of, like, the dad who was the cop in Monster Squad. Like, he was the one guy who, like, knew what was going on, but then, like, he was always, like, arguing with his wife. Like, they had a, you know, rough relationship. And I'm not, you know, I'm not going to, like, take sides on, like, a fictional, you know, divorce case from, like, a 40-year-old movie. But my point being that, like, she was clearly a mom and he was, like, hanging out with his kid on the roof eating fast food. So he was, like, one of the guys. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think in this case, we got to deal with, you know, Monica's mom here. And after having lost her husband, who was one of the guys, because he was the one who, like, was trying to look the other way while Tanner was sneaking into the amusement park and telling him to, like, you know, fucking keep it down, bro. Like, you're going to get us all in trouble. So he was one of the guys. That's why I mentioned that trope. So the mom has to be the other one. She has to be the one who is just, like, completely oblivious. So even though she's sad and maybe a little bit overprotective in this, like, mourning period, she's still going to be like, oh, honey, it'd be so good for you to go have a sleepover with your best friends. Bye. You know?
Right. Exactly. Oh, that's perfect. Yes. So I mean, like, I don't know how much time we want to spend here at the school, but, you know, we'll get our backstory out of the way for the audience, and for the sake of expediency, that backstory is go back and listen to the first episode.
Exactly. It's a really good one. You should definitely check it out. We need more downloads, please.
Indeed. So, yeah, so we know, like, you know, Tanner and his friends all went, you know, to impress these girls to try to, you know, get lucky. And Dad was kind of in on it, in the sense of, like, he looked the other way because that was, like, on his patrol. But, you know, he had to tell his son, like, hey, you know, fucking keep it down. You're turning on all the lights and shit. Like, calm down. But it doesn't end well for any of them, as Mr. Six and his ghost bus takes care of the lot. But yeah, so, like, maybe we could have, like, that night we'll see the mom. We'll meet Monica's mom. I don't know what the hell we want to call her. We'll just say mom. Because yeah. She's kind of an unimportant character.
Yeah, that's fine. She can just be mom.
But maybe we could see, like, when Monica comes home, like, her mom is just kind of sitting there, like, staring at the TV, like, picking at the couch, like, just kind of in her own little world. Yeah. You know, and then, like, have Monica be like, hi, mom, and have her be like, oh, sweetie, did you eat dinner yet? Like, completely confused on what time it is. Just so she's like, mom is going to be distant because of what she lost, you know. And it also kind of establishes Monica as a loner, because at this point it's like, she's, you know, she's this teenage girl. She lost her brother and her dad. Now her mom is completely, you know, disassociated. And, you know, she's kind of on her own to not only figure out what the fuck happened, but to figure out life in general. So I feel like that's kind of an important character arc for this character. Because unlike the first movie, I don't really want Monica to just be like this throwaway, like, I'm going to get laid at the park kind of character.
No. She needs to be definitely more well-rounded and have some more depth to her than her brother. Her brother really was the meathead. He was the one who was, like, bribing his nerdy friend to come help him and his other, like, jock bro bestie, like, break into the amusement park to impress the rich girls in town. I mean, like, there's right. so many stereotypes there. So I think we need to establish, too, that Monica – how old is she, right? If I'm thinking Tanner and Jasper, probably seniors, right? They were older. Yeah. So
like 17, 18. So maybe she's like 16.
Yeah, I was thinking. Younger. Yeah, either she's a year younger and she's in junior year, or they're like fraternal twins. You know, one of the two, like just to get them close in age. But I kind of like the idea of junior year, because that's another stereotype that was really prevalent, actually, especially in the 80s and 90s, where for some reason, it was always the juniors in high school who were the stars. Even something like Mean Girls, like those girls are juniors, not seniors. Mm-hmm. And like why they are so popular and like mature and, you know, all these and have all this freedom to like do whatever. Like they're juniors. They're like 16 years old. Like they're not even seniors in high school. And I think as an adult looking back, it doesn't make any sense to me. At the time when I was a teenager, I was like, yeah, sure, whatever. But like looking back on it, I'm like, they're just kids. What are you doing?
Why is everyone like them?
I know, like, why are they just left to their own devices? They all have like their own cars and jobs, and they just do whatever they want, and they never go home. And when they do go home, like you said, mom's always like, "Oh, I'm so happy that you're here. Can I feed you? Can I do this?" It's like because they're never around, you know. It's like, you know, the old Greek grandma that you go visit like once in a while, and she just wants to feed you and like take care of you, and you know, like it's like, but no, these are the parents you live with. Like, why are they so distant? Because the trope right. is that, you know, when you're a teenager in the 80s, it's like, well, fuck. You're grown up, right?
And parents are stupid.
Well, yeah, that's still true. I'm pretty stupid.
I mean, I'm sure my son would have a few things to say about that as well. But yeah, like so it's that whole thing of like, you know, in Hollywood, teenagers are way more mature than they actually are in real life. Because I don't know about you, but in 10th grade, I didn't know shit. Like.
I mean, again, I think at the time I thought I did, but looking back, I'm like, oh, shit. You sweet summer child.
You know? It's like I had my first real job where I worked at Media Play. But like, yeah, you know, I was still going home and playing video games and reading comic books and watching late night MTV. Like, you know, it's,
yeah, exactly.
I was still a kid. But yeah, so, you know, we'll see Monica like, you know, go up to her bedroom. Kind of throw her bag on her bed, and maybe like we see that she's been like researching the park. So like she sits down at her desk and like maybe opens up this binder, and we see news articles about the original Mr. Six murders. So like we would recognize them from the first movie where we talked about the flashback scenes of what had happened. So we see like over like kind of an over the shoulder angle of her like looking through it. So we know. She isn't just mourning, like she is looking into things. And now we should cut away and find out what Cotton Eye Joe is up to.
Yes, let's do that.
So we see, you know, obviously Monica is, you know, trying to uncover the pieces. Now I want to see like, you know, the shadowy figure with the backpack that he was carrying kind of comes strolling into town. Or maybe he's walking down. Like the interstate, you know, hitchhiking.
Okay.
And yeah. We can see him kind of like, you know, trying to come into town, get a ride, like, and eventually someone swings by and picks him up. And we could see like, it's dark out. So we're not getting a good look at his face. We just kind of, we know that he has the one blind eye.
Okay.
So yeah. I want to have this thing where it's like, it's a middle-aged woman picks him up, and we don't hear most of the conversation. We just kind of see them driving and see her like, you know, looking over at him with this smirk, like clearly she's enamored with him, like, because again in the song Cotton Eye Joe was a ladies man.
Yeah.
So and I took it as, you know, the hearts of the girls to hell broken scent. He's cutting out hearts
literally.
Right. So like, you know, he comes in, maybe she could be like, oh, so why are you in town? And be like, you know, like have him make some kind of comment of like, I don't know how I want to word it. Because the idea is I want him to be, his whole shtick is that he's going to go to any town that has recently had some kind of tragedy happen and like come rolling in and kill some victims while he's there and then escape while everything else is going on. So his whole whole idea is he's like the calamity killer, like wait for some kind of calamity and then come into town, do your business and get the fuck out before anyone realizes what happened.
Okay, that makes sense. So he's very opportunistic and he's looking for situations where he can get away with his serial killings because people are so focused on something else that's going on, like some other tragedy, like you mentioned. So that makes me wonder, is he just a serial killer because he likes killing, or is does he have some kind of ulterior motive? Like why the hearts? Is it just because he likes taking trophies, or is he doing something with those hearts?
Well, and that's the thing I kind of left up to interpretation. Like, I figured we could either figure it out or maybe leave it open-ended. Because I was like, the idea was that serial killers usually take trophies, and because of the heart line in the song, I'm like, fuck it. Yeah, he collects hearts. Why not? You know, like, what was it? Was it Red Dragon? Dude collected, like, hands. Like, you know, there's all different stories of serial killers where they collect something, you know.
It makes perfect sense, and that's fine. I don't think it needs to be any more complicated than like those are just his trophies, so that's fine. Yeah, so to your point, he sees the news coverage and he's gonna like blow into town. And okay, so I'm not sure how to explain that. We'll have to maybe wait until he can have some kind of like a villain speech at some point later on. In the meantime, yeah, let's just kind of keep it mysterious and maybe make it seem like it's more connected to Mr. Six than it really is. Like, he's not really connected to Mr. Six in any way, but, you know, to the people watching this movie, they might assume that he is because they're like, oh, there's this other killer who, like, watches it on TV and is just like, oh, I got to go there.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, again, the viewer might be thinking, oh, well, shit, like, you know, how is this guy connected to, you know, the Darien Lake Mr. Six killer? Like, you know, what's going on? And of course, that's going to be a little bit of the reveal later, right? That it's like, it's a little bit disappointing that no, he was just being opportunistic and like taking advantage of the situation because he just likes fucking stabbing people.
He's just a fucking serial killer. But like, we could even have like some of that dialogue here, like have like, you know, the lady picked him up, be like, you know, oh, you know, like what brings you to town, or like, where are you headed? And have him maybe, I don't think we ever named the town that this takes place on.
I don't think the town was barely in the first movie because it was mostly just at like the school and then the weird little amusement park where BB worked, the little kiddie ride one, and then at Darien Lake itself. So, you know what? We named the amusement park Darien Lake because that was our local amusement park that was a Six Flags franchise, Six Flags over Darien Lake because of the connection to Mr. Six. But we kind of wanted to separate it from the Six Flags company and, you know, not mention that Mr. Six was called Mr. Six because he rode the number six. Because he drove the number six bus, not because of Six Flags, and the amusement park was just called Darien Lake, and it was unaffiliated, which is my big, long explanation of saying, let's just call this Darien something, like it's Darien Falls, right? Let's just call it
okay.
That.
Okay, that works.
Like, you know, like Niagara Falls, Darien Falls, and so, yeah, this is, you know, Darien Falls High School, and we'll go from there.
So, yeah, so we'll have her say something like, so, you know, so what brings you into town, or what brings you into Darien Falls? Like, are you here on business? And have him say something like, you know, yeah, you could say that, like just kind of keeping it vague, you know, and all that, and be like, oh, you know, I don't know if you heard, but we recently had a really horrible tragedy happen. And she could maybe even point like, it's actually just up the road here. You'll see a bunch of blockades and everything, and have him say like, you know, that's kind of why I'm here. And she's like, oh, are you doing a report on it? Like, kind of all excited, and have him be like, no, I'm planning to add to it. And have her be like, wait, what? And have him just pull out the fucking knife, and then you see the car swerve around. You know, and then eventually, like, have, like, we'll pan the camera out. We'll see the car on the side of the road. Like, maybe it's, like, dusk, right? There's no other cars on the road. We see the brake lights. You know, we see the car shaking around a little bit, and then we see the door open. We see the woman's body get tipped out with a giant gaping hole in her chest. And then the door closed and the car drive on. Like, oh, shit.
He was just like, you know, funny you mentioned that. And then like, okay, I'm done with you. Like, I just wanted the one part.
I mean, I needed a ride, so I just took your car and your heart, you know.
No big deal.
Yeah, Cotton Eye Joe is a killer.
Okay, so Cotton Eye Joe is in town. He's in Darien Falls. We know he's a killer. He takes hearts. Perfect. I think it's cool that he just has one white eye, because while the song that we're referencing is traditionally called Cotton Eyed Joe with a hyphen and a D, the redneck's version of the song doesn't have the hyphen and doesn't have the D. It's just Cotton Eye Joe, which is cool because it's like it's a singular eye. He's got one cotton looking white eye, which is pretty cool.
Exactly. And I mean, like, it did kind of change the song a little bit, because it talks about, you know, his eyes and his smile, like how nice they were. And I'm like, well, he's got one white eye, but I feel like a rugged dude could still pull that look off.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. You know, his eyes are still nice. You know, white's pretty.
Right, exactly.
I just want to paint a broad stroke real quick. So I'm kind of like where I'm going in my head is.
Yeah.
Monica and her Scooby friends, so they should be the next scene. We got to cut back to them and cut back to them. And I'm not sure if it's Monica or Tanya, but one of them is going to be the little bit of a ringleader who's like, I really need to know what happened. Like, I want to see it for myself. Like, what's up with this amusement park? You know, what really happened? Like, you know, this story about, you know, Mr. Six, you know, whatever. Like, that's garbage, because that was 20 years ago. There's no way. Like, you know, what was out there? And of course, they get it into their heads, like, you know, more stereotypes from the 80s and 90s that, like, you know, they can go, like, you know, solve this dangerous mystery all by themselves.
Yep.
So they're going to go out there. And actually, you know what? Again, this is part of why I wanted to set the personalities, because it helps with making storytelling decisions. We had said that Drew is going to be fascinated by all the gory details. So what if Tanya is kind of like the ringleader, because she gets really excited, but Drew is the one who plants the seed. Drew is the one who's like, well, you know, like, maybe we should go out to, like, the crime scene. Maybe there'll be some clues, you know, because he wants to see, like, blood stains, but he's kind of, like, dropping the hint. And then Tanya's going to be like, that's it. That's perfect. We got to go out there. We got to, like, look at the clues. We're going to solve the mystery, like, fucking Scooby-Doo. Like, just put it on Front Street, you know? And Monica, of course, doesn't want to do that, because it's like, no, like, my brother and my dad were killed there. But Tanya's personality is just going to dominate, and all the rest of the friend group is going to, you know, kind of close in and be like, yeah, this is perfect. It'll be like therapy. You can, like, see it and face it and blah, 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 all this shit. So, you know, they're going to convince her that they need to go to the amusement park and, like, look for clues. And again, I'm kind of painting in broad strokes, because what I'm saying is this is the next scene. And then we're going to have some more scenes, obviously, like, telling that story. But Cotton Eye Joe, who's in town looking for more opportunistic people to murder, you know, and get away with it, at some point he needs to find out from somebody that there are six teenagers off by themselves at a secluded amusement park somewhere. And he's just like, bingo, you know.
It's funny you should mention that, because this is one of the scenes that I had where the two would collide. So I didn't write the full scene, but you talking about that just kind of solidified how we're going to do it. So originally I had the whole Scooby Gang idea. Originally it was going to be Monica's idea, but I love this idea that it's Drew's. So let's go. We'll cut that Cotton Eye Joe killing scene was clearly at dusk. It was that night. We saw the kids leave school. You know, we saw Monica go home. So let's cut. It's the next day. Like, we'll start with the bell ringing again. We see the kids all walking away from school, like maybe walking out to the parking lot, all talking. And then smash cut, have them at the fucking clown dog or clown burger, whatever it was from the first one that BB worked at, sitting around, like, you know, just fucking eating. Like, maybe it's a Friday night, right? So they're sitting there, like, munching on burgers and dogs and talking, and have, like, you know, maybe Matt's like, you know, so what's everyone doing for the weekend, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, have Monica say something along the lines of, she needs closure. And, like, you know, what do you mean? They're like, she's like, I can't stop thinking about it. And then have Drew make the comment that you said, where he's like, well, you know, it's the weekend. Like, I don't know if anyone's going to really be around there. Like, it's the media circus has kind of died down a little bit. Maybe we should take a drive and look around. Like, maybe there will be clues. And have, like you said, you know, Tanya with her bubbly personality be like, fuck yes, bitch, we're doing that. We're going to get you closure. We're going to solve the mystery. Fuck yeah, Scooby Gang unite. You know, just like total like psycho vibes.
Yeah, absolutely. That's perfect. And, like, okay, so before that, like, toward the beginning of the scene where we're kind of setting the, we're setting the scene and kind of showing what's going on, we got to have Matt, because he's like the TikTok guy. He's got to be like with his phone up, like doing like selfie video, like, you know, like, you know, you're like, what's up, buddies, or whatever. He's talking to his audience or whatever on TikTok, and he's like panning the camera around to like show, you know, like, we're out here at like, you know, at the Clown Burger tonight, like, you know, getting it down or whatever he's doing, like whatever bullshit he's saying, you know. And it's like he's airing what they're doing. And of course, you know, focus, you see Monica's face come up on like, you know, his phone screen. She's just staring like daggers at him, like, get that fucking camera off of me, you know.
Right.
So he's going to put his phone away. But I mentioned this again for storytelling purposes, because we got to get rid of cell phones. So again, let's connect the dots between this conversation and getting to the amusement park. But I want to have that scene happen where you see Matt try to do this like selfie, like live stream. And then later on, when they get to the amusement park, Matt's going to pull his phone out again and be like, oh, like, I know we're not supposed to be here, but I can't miss this opportunity. Like, look at this fucking place. So he's going to go try to like live stream it. And then he's got no signal, like no bars, whatever.
I love it. I know. I'm sorry. I don't mean to cut you off. I love it. I have an idea to get rid of the cell phones, but keep going.
Okay. No, that's fine. That's all I was going to say. I was just going to say, like, this could be an opportunity to, you know, take the cell phone loving guy and then use him as the story bit for like why they can't call for help whenever they're going to need it later, you know, because he's going to try and live stream. And for whatever reason, you know, there's no signal. And it's like, that's an easy way to get rid of him. If you have a better idea, cool. I was just throwing it out there.
Oh, I just have a fun, like, kind of make the audience laugh type of moment. But I love this idea of him doing live stream, because it connects very well to what I was thinking of for this scene. So we'll see the Scooby gang sitting around talking, and like Matt, have him like kind of standing up next to them doing his live stream, kind of like off panel or off camera. You like, we hear him talking like, you know, hey, what's up, besties, like doing that whole thing while they're discussing this, you know, going and breaking into the amusement park and finding clues. While Matt's panning around the room, like, we're going to see like the camera, like we're focusing on his cell phone camera, like the front facing camera, as he's panning by. And we could see sitting at one of the booths, we see a very familiar looking man kind of like looking one eye over at him,
right,
you know, listening in, like clearly eavesdropping. So Cotton Eye Joe is like, oh shit, like, you know, ready-made victims. Okay.
Yeah.
So he's eating his burger and just kind of listening in. But yeah, to your point, we have Monica be like, get that fucking thing out of my face, you know, blah, blah, blah. And maybe have Rose like snap at him and be like, do you always have to fucking do that? Like, you know, read the room, asshole, like that kind of thing, you know, and have him be like, all right. And put the phone away. But then have Drew kind of go on about like, you know, how easy it would be to break in. And maybe he even says like, we let a little bit of his insensitivity slip here. Cause I love the idea of Drew almost liking serial killers too much, like to the point where, you know, he dresses very milk toast and tries to like put on the fake, like, I'm not really like that, like many serial killers do. Like, maybe he could even do something like where it slips a little, be like, you know, yeah, it would be really easy. I mean, your brother got in, right? And like have him almost like that, almost like excited, and have them look at him. He's like, well, I just meant, you know, it might be easy to get in, because you know Tanner, you know, God rest his soul, you know, he wasn't super bright, you know, like have him just kind of like fumbling with his words very awkwardly, like, oh shit, how do I get out of this?
And it's like a terrible excuse. And then of course Tanya is going to look at him, or Rose is going to look at him and be like, you know, like, real fucking smooth asshole, like, you know, because he just like insulted, you know, Monica's brother because he was trying to backpedal out of like saying something dumb, and he just like doubled down and said something even dumber, you know?
Exactly. Like, I love it.
Yeah, so let's have them pile out of here, and this is where we need to set up David's personality, who so far has just kind of been like one of the gang so far. Let's have David be one of them who has a car, right? So let's have two of them have a car. It doesn't matter who the other one is, but David's got to have a car, because he's going to be the one who, as they're like, you know, walking out to the parking lot, he's going to be like, oh, Monica, like, you ride with me, ride up front with me, you know? Mm-hmm. And,
I'm sorry, real quick, we could even have a scene before that, like when they're getting ready to leave, like, and they're all getting their trays, like with the, you know, their garbage on it, have him be like, oh here, Monica, I got yours, and like have him grab hers, and then have Matt and Rose be like, oh man, thanks, Dave, and just pile all theirs on, and have him be like, yeah, no problem, guys, and just go to dump the garbage while they all walk out in the parking lot.
Exactly, right? Yeah, so they all walk out, and then you see David, like, run after them, like, to catch up, and he's like, Monica, like, ride with me. Like, hey, you should ride with me, like, you know.
Yes! And, that is perfect.
And so we'll cut to them, like, driving. It's getting darker now, and during this ride, you know, Monica's gonna say something like, you know, David, like, you've always been such a good friend. You know, Tanya's great, but she gets so wild, and it's so nice to have someone like you around who's, like, so level-headed. You know, he's like, you're just like the brother that I never had. It is so great. Or not brother, because Tanner died, but, you know, like, yeah. Maybe, you know, like, you know, you're just such a great friend, and I just love having you around. And, you know, and of course, you know, David, he's just dying inside, like, hearing her, you know, tell him that he's a friend. But the whole time he's, like, listening, like, oh yeah, you know, I'm always here for you. And then we just see, like, close up on his eyes, like, looking to the side, and then we see what he's looking at, and he's totally, like, trying to, like, look down her shirt and, like, look at her legs, you know, like, he's just, like, trying to, like, catch a glimpse of something while maintaining this, you know, facade of, like, you know, oh yeah, I'm totally, like, your best friend. But, you know, he's just
oh my god. Yeah, we could have, like, her make a comment and be like, you know, you're like my little brother, and have him be like, dude, I'm only, like, 2 months younger than you. She's like, you're still little, you know, like, you make, and, like, just, like, daggers, like, oh god, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And there has to be that sequence where he goes to, like, adjust the mirror because he's going to try to, like, get a better look, and then, like, the camera focuses on the mirror and you see, like, Rose in the back seat.
Yes! Who's
just, like, staring knowingly in the mirror at him, like, you stupid motherfucker, you know.
And then he adjusts it back real quick. Yeah, like, oh shit, exactly.
Like, she doesn't say anything, she's just like, I'm on to you, you know.
Before that happens, like, when they're all piling in the car, like, before that conversation, we'll have the, like, you know, him do the whole thing that you said, like, oh, you know, oh, Monica, yeah, ride with me. I mean, you know, you should sit up here, like, that whole thing. They all get into the car. Maybe, like, we'll see, like, Rose is kind of, like, shaking her head knowingly, smoking a cigarette, and, like, flicks it as they pile in. And then we see, you know, Cotton Eye Joe walk out of the diner and do, again, the close-up on his smile. And then we see the kids driving on the highway, or driving on the, you know, the interstate toward Daring Lake. And then we have that whole play out, like you said, where he's clearly trying to, like, you know, be like, I'm there for you, but I kind of want you, like, that whole thing.
Yeah. Real quick before we go further, I love this idea of, you know, Cotton Eye Joe watching them leave. You mentioned the cigarette. It's just one of these, like, little cinematic things that's fun to do, where Rose flicks the cigarette, doesn't put it out, just flicks it. And then, you know, as they get in the car, we just see the close up of the cigarette, and then, like, this black boot comes down and grinds it out, and the camera pans up, and there's Cotton Eye Joe watching them get in the car. Like, just a little thing to, like, have the camera follow the cigarette over to him, and he's just standing there, like, watching them drive away.
Wait, even creepier, dude. I love that idea, but I'm going to take it one step further. So same exact thing, like you said, cigarette gets flicked, lands on the ground. We see a shadow of someone, like, go over the cigarette from, like, the worm's eye view, like you said, reach down and pick it up. And then we see a close up of him, like, sniff the end of the cigarette, like the filter where there's, like, lipstick on it. And then just kind of lick it, and, like, or maybe puts it out on his fucking tongue. There we go. He puts it out on his tongue, and then we get the close up of the smile.
Oh,
so
we'll triple down on it. He picks it up, sniffs it a little bit. He puts it in his mouth, takes a big drag on it, licks the filter a little bit, and then puts it out on his tongue.
Yes, perfect. Yes. Because I really want to establish Cotton Eye Joe as, like, this creepy, like sexual deviant kind of serial killer, because again, the song is all about him fucking women. Like, it's all about him coming into town and, like, breaking up relationships and fucking all the ladies so good that they run away and leave their men. Like, so
yeah,
I want him to be like very sexually focused.
Yeah, totally. So as he's doing that, instead of cutting back to the Scooby gang right away, let's have him hear a voice. He hears a voice of, like, you know, a couple of people who are leaving the little clown burger, and, you know, a couple of maybe, you know, ladies with, like, a couple of kids, and the one of these women who is going to go get in their car by themselves, and he hears them, that woman, say to her friends, like, oh no, it's fine, like, you know, I'm just gonna drive home, like, no big deal, you guys go out and have fun, like, I'm so tired, I'm just gonna go home. And so, of course, she gets in her car by herself, and then you just see the close-up of Cotton Eye Joe's mouth, and the corner of his mouth just smirks just a little bit. And so the next time that we see him, he's driving in that woman's
yes!
car.
Yes!
And that's how he's going to follow the Scooby Gang to Darien Lake.
I love it. I love it. Because of course he would have to ditch the other car because it was covered in blood. So yes. He'd have to like ditch it somewhere. But oh, I fucking love it, dude. Because I was originally thinking like, yeah, he would just drive the car he stole. But yeah, it would be completely covered in blood because he carved a heart out in it.
Yeah, he'll just abandon that at the fucking Clown Burger for someone to find later. And then, you know, take this this poor single lady who is trying to go home and, like, you know, get some sleep because she was tired from work. And, you know, we don't even show what happened. We're just going to smash cut to back to the Scooby Gang, whatever they're talking about. And then we'll have the sequence where, like, the camera, like, goes out the back window of their car, goes down the street. You see some headlights and then zooms in. And here's, you know, Cotton Eye Joe driving in that lady's car. And it's something very distinguishable that you could immediately recognize it, you know, like it was a, right. You know, I don't know, like a Camaro or something. Very obvious that it was the same car.
We could even have like, you know, like do the camera zoom where it's like, it zooms in, we see Cotton Eye Joe in the front seat, and we zoom into the floorboards in the back seat, and her fucking corpse is laying there. It's just like, because again, he don't fucking care. He's going to abandon this car too. Like,
yeah, exactly. Okay, perfect. Oh, so, man. Okay. I feel like we've done a lot of setup and I'm just doing like a quick time check. So let's get to the good shit, right? Let's get these people.
We got to get them to the park.
Yeah, let's get them to the amusement park. So let's just fast forward a little bit, kind of gloss through a couple of scenes. The crew gets there. You know, they see the, just like our stinger group at the beginning, they see the roller coaster is kind of tipped over. Somebody's going to make a comment about like, what the fuck, like, how did that happen? Like, what's going on out here? Blah, blah, blah. And, you know, that's when they're going to walk up. So my question is, are they going to see anything still left over from the murders a couple weeks ago? Or is it like, it's all cleaned up. It's like police taped off. Like, you know, what's the scene we're going to set before they break in?
Well, I think it'll be, yeah, we're going to see, and I'm sure you've seen this before, where people set up those, like, the big, like, you know, rolled out metal fence, where set it, like, up around the actual fence to the Darien Lake. Like, it would be, like, a police blockade set up. So they'd have to get past that and then obviously get into the actual park. So we'll see all the, like, do not cross, police line, blah, 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 blah. We'll see all that stuff. And maybe, like, when they first pull up, you know, maybe have, you know, Drew being the fascinated by true crime, have him be like, no, don't park in the fucking parking lot. That's too visible. Like, park over here on this utility road. So they like park off to the side and like walk over to the enclosure and have, this is where Matt can pull out his phone and be like, you know, hey guys, it's your buddy Matt, you know, live streaming from Darien. Like, have like Rose knock his phone out of his hand, like, you asshole, you know, to be like, oh shit, I forgot, sorry. Like, you know, kind of. So we do establish that the phones work, because this is going to be a key moment later.
Okay.
So, you know, he puts his phone back in his pocket and have them all kind of like looking around, and maybe they're all standing at the outside of the blockade gate, and they're just kind of like, you know, hands on the gate, like looking in. And have maybe Tanya says something like, do you think there's anything left in there? Like, would they have cleaned it up? And then have Drew be like, well, no, it's probably all cleaned up by now, but I'm sure they have all the crime scenes marked off. He goes, there might even be some stains on the pavement. And then have like Rose fetch him upside the head like, dude, and be like, sorry. I mean, you know, there might clues. We're looking for clues.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and I like the fact that Rose is kind of a little abrasive, and she hasn't revealed her fear yet, you know, that she's like icky around blood. Like, she's, you know, so this is perfect. But let's just go ahead and have them sneak in. Let's not belabor the point. Let's, you know, maybe somebody, you know, like David is, you know, going to be like, I don't know, like, how the fuck are we going to get in there? And of course, again, Drew, he's like the expert. He's like, oh, like, you know, these barriers are nothing. Like, this is just, you know, symbolic or whatever. And like he just picks up the bottom of it and is like, you know, go right in, you know, like he's holding up the bottom of the chain like he's a doorman, like, you know, and, you know, like, ladies first, you know, whatever. So like, they just go in under the barrier. And then when they get close to the fence for the actual amusement park, they find that there's some kind of a door, whether it's like one of the gates or whether it's like a man door, but it's open, like unlocked, because of course the police and stuff were getting in and out of there. It's taped off, but, you know, we're gonna have you know, have Matt walk up and like karate chop that police tape, you know.
Hassan chop. Just takes it out.
You know, and it's, he gives Drew a little bit of a smirk, like he one-upped him, you know, like, you know, right. You may have held open the fence, but haha, I chopped the tape, you know, like, just because, you know, he's having too much fun.
Right, right. To your point, like, he kind of, like, one-ups him, like, you know, yeah, you lifted it up, but I was like, haha, I took it out, you know, fuck you, that type of thing. So, yeah, but while they're all walking in, again, we're going to do the camera pan out. Maybe see Cotton Eye Joe kind of watching them from just outside the mm-hmm. enclosure, the police enclosure. So now we know he not only was he following them, but like he's there. So it's like, oh, shit, like he's coming for their hearts. So, yeah, so we're going to have the teens walking around the park. And we do want to have like a few things, like maybe they because they're going to see like the police do not cross things around all the murder sites, or at least all the sites where they found the bodies. So like. They'd probably see the Plinko board that the one girl was shoved onto, yeah. You know, and there would be maybe like blood stains there, and have like we could have Drew just be like his mask could slip a little where he's like, oh, dude, and like climb over the like the carnival game thing, like to get a better look. And maybe Matt like snaps a photo and have this is where we could have Rose be like, oh, OK, no. And like kind of look like. She no longer is acting like the badass. She's acting like really queasy and skeeved out by what she's seeing.
Okay, yeah.
So mm-hmm. we could kind of establish that right away. And maybe have Tanya be like, dude, you all right? You all right? do you need an Advil? Yeah, I got... And then, like, start rummaging through her purse. Like, I got Tylenol. I got this. I just start... And I'd be like, no, I'm fine. Like, I don't like the sight of blood, you know, maybe something like that.
Yeah. And of course, you know, Matt's or somebody's got to give her shit. And as soon as she says that out loud and it's like, you know, like, oh, like, you know, badass, you know, goth chick Rose, like you can't stand a little blood, you know,
Gothy McGotherson over here. Can't stand exactly. some blood.
She's like, you know, shut up. Like, hey, I just, you know, when it's real blood, it's like, you know, and of course, you know, Drew or someone would be like, dude, yeah, but like. We watch all those horror movies all the time and you like love all the gore. She's like, yeah, when it's fake, but you know, real blood is like different, you know?
I mean, to be fair, that's kind of how I am. Cause like, I totally love, you know, horror movies. Obviously anyone who knows me knows that, but like the few times I've seen like a real accident or like someone really badly hurt, I get weak in the knees and I get like the butterflies in my stomach. I'm like, oh God, like I get, really uncomfortable real quick, which is why I could never like, you know, be an actual surgical nurse or something. Like I would lose my shit. So yeah. Not for
ironically, I always feel worse for like the people that like it hurts a lot or that they're going to be like, you know, disfigured or, you know, whatever, they're dead and their family is going to be sad. Like, I always feel bad. Like, oh man, like there's such a bummer that this accident or whatever is going to like ruin your life and your family's life. But at the same time, it's like, ooh, can I see?
See, I get super squeamish. I'm like,
oh man. Okay. So, we finally got everybody in the amusement park. Now we got to start knocking them off.
Yep. So, yeah. So let's have them like going around like scene by scene, like kind of almost reminding the audience like what happened in the first movie. Like we could even do that tried and true horror trope where it's like we see the Plinko board. Right. And mm-hmm. we see the crime scene. And like we do the thing, like I said, where Matt climbs over and David takes out his phone. He's like, oh, dude, he snaps a photo. And when he clicks the photo, we could do a quick like transition shot of I forget who it was. I think it was Janet. Was like stabbed on the Plinko mm-hmm. board. So we could do kind of like that quick transition with like the ghostly scream and then cut back to present day just to kind of like remind the audience like, yeah, someone died here.
Oh, that's perfect. Yeah, let's do that. And then do the same thing. Like they already pointed out the roller coaster was like all leaning to the side because the Vengabus like kind of knocked it over. Same thing, you know, when as they're walking, they get closer to it, somebody's going to mention like, oh, like be careful. Like, yeah, it's taped off, but like for a reason, like that thing could come down any second. Same thing, you know, Drew or somebody like looks up to like snap a picture. Same thing. You know, we see like a sepia toned like flashback to, mm-hmm. you know, the, and then like, and then like the dude who just explodes at the bottom of the ramp.
Right. So yeah, so like, and of course, like, that area is going to have this big like stain on the pavement, because remember the four from the Stinger were run down right there in front of the roller coaster. So there's going to be like this big area roped off, and like we could have, you know, we could do the thing with Rose again where she's like getting kind of queasy, and maybe like she runs off to puke, like she's like, oh god no, and like runs like a little bit away from the group to go throw up, and like Tanya goes running after her, be like, oh crap, hold on, do you need some Pepto, like just like running after her. And have you know, maybe Monica said something to like David and Drew, or Matt and Drew, being like, you know, you guys don't have to be so excited about this, all right, like not all of us are happy to be here, and this is where David's like, yeah guys, like, you know, show some respect, and like awkwardly try to put his arm around Monica. Oh, yes. And like ever just kind of look at him, like he never quite gets it around, or he's like doing that like hover hand where he's like trying, like, can I put it on her shoulder, should I put it on her shoulder, like doing that thing, and ever just looks at him like pull his hand back.
okay, so that has to be like the trigger, that's the signal for the 80s horror movie to kill this guy, like, it's, you know what I mean, like,
yep.
he has proven himself to be a dick, so he's got to go. We're gonna break him up. I think this is perfect, this, the kind of like moving them around, this little drama, we can easily break them up in a very natural way. So yeah, to your point, Rose is gonna kind of go off the side and kind of try to throw up, or like around a corner, or like behind a booth somewhere. China's gonna run over and try to like make sure she's okay. She grabs her big purse, you know, pulling out Pepto or, you know, Tums or whatever. And David's going to do that thing. He puts her arms around her. Monica's going to, like, get fed up. At this point, like, she's really upset. Everyone's making fucking jokes. David is just skeevy in this moment. So she's going to, like, grab his hand and, like, kind of throw it back at him and then stomp off. Like, oh, like, you know, just she's sick of everybody's bullshit, right? And Tanya is going to see that and be like, you fucking dicks. And then she's going to run out after Monica. So she was just helping Rose. Now she's going to run after Monica. Rose is going to kind of be sitting there on the ground, like looking green, like taking a deep breath, like trying to, you know, kind of get her senses. Drew is like still like taking pictures and all fascinated. Matt, I think, should, you know, kind of go after Tanya and Monica. So what we get here is we get Drew, who's kind of lingering, taking photos. Rose just sitting on the ground. David, who's like looking real like embarrassed all of a sudden. And so now we have the group split into two, and it's really easy for us to, let's have David, maybe he like goes off to pout and like kick rocks for a second while he's waiting
Perfect.
For, you know, Drew and Rose to get their shit together. Like he's like, oh, come on guys, like let's go. And they're like, fucking give me a second. And he's going to like, oh, grumble, you know, go over and like kick something. And, you know, he's going to end up, he'll kick like an old can and it's going to roll up and like hit somebody's boot, you know, or whatever, you know.
Perfect. Well, see, what I was thinking is like, so yeah, so perfect that you split David off, because I was originally going to have everyone else walk away once he started explaining how we need to split him up, but this is even better. So yeah, so have him walk off to go pout, and like we could do the camera fall, like we'll see behind him. Matt is back to like recording and like this is going to be great for my Instagram or whatever. And then have like Drew is maybe sitting by Rose, because like they're friends, like awkward friends. So have Drew be like, you know, you all right? Like I never knew that you were so grossed out by the real stuff. Like I wouldn't have been talking about all those serial killers had I known, like that kind of a thing.
Sure. Yeah. I like that they're friends, and that, like, let's not have Drew be like David. Like, he's not Steven on Rose. He's just genuinely, like, they're besties who watch horror movies. And he's like, oh, I didn't know that you were squeamish.
It's kind of like me and Tara or me and Sam, where we're just, like, buddies watching horror movies and, like, shooting the shit, you know. And it's not like that at all, you know, like that. Because that's the thing. Like, as a guy who's mostly had lady friends his whole life, like, I've had a ton of friends like that, where it's just like, yeah, you know, like, let's fucking watch a movie, like that type of thing. Don't be David. Never be David.
Exactly.
So he walks off by himself and he's like kind of kicking rocks and looking around. And maybe we see like the door to the funhouse, like kind of blowing in the wind, like creak, creak, you know, and I'm be like, nice. What the fuck's that? You know, like, cause again, remember we killed a couple people in there, and have him go like, look over it. So we're making the audience think like, you know, oh shit, like he's going to get killed. Like he's going into the fucking funhouse where Mr. Six killed the other guy. You know, so he goes in, like, goes up to the funhouse. Maybe he, like, peeks in the door. And he's like, ah, fuck that. And he turns around. And then we do a close-up on his face, like, like a shock, like, intake of breath. And then we pan out and we just see fucking his throat has been stabbed. And Cotton Eye Joe is standing in front of him going, shh. And then nice. He cuts his fucking heart out.
Yeah, I like that. I like the shh as like his little trademark. I like that. Yeah, perfect. Let's have the camera cut like right when he like he says like the, you know, the shush. And then maybe he puts his arm on David's shoulder and just like, you know, very kind of slowly and carefully shoves his knife in between his ribs. And then we cut right there, you know.
Oh, fuck yeah.
You know, like, you know, he cut his throat so he can't scream. Now he's got a minute to like do the job, you know.
Oh, that's so creepy.
Exactly. All right, so yeah, so let's cut back over to Rose and David at this point, and you know, or Rose and Drew, and you know, Drew, while he's creepy, like he's not a total like douchebag, so he's like, all right, Rose, you're good, let's go. He's gonna grab her arms, he's gonna like pull her to her feet, like, all right, like let's get back in the game, you know, and they're gonna kind of, you know, go off to follow the other three. So which of course now the question is, do we have them catch up or do we keep Drew and Rose separated?
I think we keep people separated for the moment. Because like I want to have like maybe Drew and Rose start walking toward where Monica and Tanya kind of disappeared to, and we kind of leave Matt by himself for a moment. Like he's still like taking video and like talking to himself on camera, like, oh, I'll be posting all this later, you know, like once Monica, you know, chills out, that type of thing. Like he cares about his friend, but he's still kind of a dick, cares more about himself than anybody else. So have him doing that whole thing. And then I want him to like I want him to eventually stumble upon David's corpse. So here's the idea. Like he's like walking around like filming and, you know, and then maybe he sees like the funhouse. He's like, you know, oh, yeah, you know, I heard that one of the bodies was found in the funhouse. Let's go check it out, gang. And like goes over there and he sees like maybe he sees like boots hanging out of the door, like the door that's like that was slamming into the side of the building. Now yes. It's just like hitting legs. And he's like, what the fuck is that? And like as soon as he gets close enough to actually film it, his phone should like the recording should stop and have him be like, the fuck, what's going on? And then look over and be like, oh my god, is that David? Like, oh fuck, what happened? I gotta get the rest of the guys. And like he goes to call on his phone, and as soon as he opens his phone up, it just goes da 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 da, da. And like he can't do anything with it. It just starts playing the fucking music.
Oh, I love that. Like it's just the music coming on his phone. And he's just like have him get started. Like, ah, fuck, shit, you know.
And just like drop his phone. Like, ah, what the hell?
Yeah, like he drops it and like it cracks, and then he's just like, oh, god damn it. Like, you know, he's like, fuck. Like, you know, the screen is cracked, and he's just like throwing a little hissy fit. Like, what the fuck? God damn it. Kind of forgets about like the legs that he just saw in the doorway. And let's just for a second cut over to like Monica and Tanya and just or better yet, Rose and Drew, just for a second, and have them hear Matt like throwing a hissy fit and have them stop and turn and look, and then just have Rose be like, Matt just lost his signal, and yeah, he's fucking throwing a hissy fit. He'll be fine in a minute. Like, just to kind of like, it's like that he's crying wolf to them, just so that like when he like screams in a minute, they're going to ignore it, you know what I mean, because they're not that far away, you know.
Right, exactly. So yeah, so like he'll freak out, and then have him be like, he picks up his phone, puts it in his pocket, like, son of a bitch. Like maybe he says something like, my dad's gonna kill me, this is the third time I've broken a screen this year, you know. And then like he turns the corner and we see the corpse of David, like, again, eyes rolled back in his head, throat slit, chest ripped open, heart gone. And have him, like, just kind of stagger back and just start screaming. And then, yeah, to your point, have Rose be like, oh, my God, he's such a fucking drama queen. He breaks his damn phone all the time. And every time he's got to have a temper tantrum, like, have some kind of thing like that. But while that's happening, have, like, we'll also cut to Monica and Tanya, who are a little bit further ahead. Have them hear the scream and turn and be like, what the fuck was that? Like, was that Matt? And then when they say that, have headlights turn on behind them.
Oh, nice.
So it's just like have them turn, and then suddenly there's something driving at them. So they jump out of the way as the fucking ghost bus goes flying past and be like, what the fuck was that? And then maybe, you know, have Rose and Drew catch up to them, be like, what's going on? What was that? What was there a car in here? I would be like, I don't fucking know. We almost got hit. While that's all happening and Matt's screaming, do we want to have Mr. Six or Cotton Eye Joe take out Matt? Because I think Matt needs to go next.
Okay, so I don't know what your vision is for Mr. Six, but I kind of have this idea that, and let me just, you know, kind of play my hand here for a second so that we're not stepping on each other, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So having Cotton Eye Joe as the killer in the movie, I think, is great. He should be the primary killer. I think we should make it known that the Mr. Six ghost bus, that it really is a ghost bus, and it's mm-hmm. it's here and it's in the amusement park, and there's like a couple of things that happen that let us know that this is a haunted amusement park, like the music playing from Matt's phone, the ghost bus that just rushed past him just now that they like barely caught a glimpse of. But I kind of want to keep Mr. Six in the bus off the game board for a little while. Like, let's let Cotton Eye Joe hunt these kids and save Mr. Six in the bus for like a climax when the bus finally comes, really comes. It's like, you know, Jaws, right? Where it's like when you finally get to see the shark, it's really going to make an impact. But when it shows up, like, I kind of feel like Mr. Six would be jealous that this other killer who's in his park killing his victims. Like, what the fuck, you know? So I think in order to make that, you know, kind of build up that tension between the two killers, let's let Cotton Eye Joe play a little bit, and then we'll bring the bus in later, like for like a third act reveal almost. Does that make sense?
So we'll do the thing where we're just kind of reminding the audience, like, yeah, there's still a ghost bus here. So it goes flying by, have them all confused and scared and wanting to know what the hell's going on. And maybe we could even do that. We could repeat the same joke. We could have them like pull out their cell phones and try to call their friends and have all of their cell phones do the da-da-da-da-da-da-da and then like go dead on, be like, what the fuck? Like, just all freaking out.
No, that's perfect. Yeah. It's a real like tinny MIDI version of the song too, you know? Right. But yeah, so, and then they're like, well, we got to go back. Like, what the fuck? Like that was Matt, right? That was Matt. And so they start kind of walking backwards, and then I think we should kill Matt, but let's have it that they see somebody. Monica and Tanya, they don't know who it is, but they see movement at the fence where they broke in. Don't forget, it's like twilight, so they can't really see. And then then somebody like gets in like their car or one of the cars, like maybe Matt was driving the other car, gets in one of the cars and then like drives off with it. And they're both like, what the fuck? Like, was that Matt? Did Matt just fucking leave? Like, what the hell happened? Like, did he see something? And Tanya is just kind of asking, Monica's going like ashen pale, like, what the fuck? Like, you know, cause her brother was killed here. Her dad was killed here. So she's suddenly like freaking out. Like, what the fuck just happened? Matt screamed and then like drove off. But the reality is that wasn't Matt driving off, because Cotton Eye Joe already killed Matt and then went out and like took the car and like drove it into the woods and left it there. Like, he's hiding the evidence. Like, he's getting rid of the car. You know what I mean? Nice. But it's just like a diversion. It's a misdirection for Monica and Tanya to think that Matt left, so that when we see Matt again, it'll be that whole Jason thing where like his body falls out of the ceiling at some point. You know what I mean? And it's like, he didn't drive off. Cotton Eye Joe was just trying to cover the tracks of like, I got to get rid of all these cars, you know?
Nice. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So, well, okay. Then in that case, let's backtrack for a moment and let's not have them park on the utility road that we had before. Let them have park in the parking lot, have Cotton Eye Joe park on the utility road. So then we can have, at this point, cause, we'll have like, he already killed David. So he's got the car keys. So now he kills mm-hmm. Matt. Like you said, like, we don't know what happens to Matt. So Matt dies off screen. We'll find his body later, but we see, to your point, Cotton Eye Joe heading toward the gate. They think it's Matt. They see the headlights turn on and the car drive away. And they're like, dude, what the fuck? And maybe that's when they try to use their cell phones to call Matt and be like, dude, what are you doing? And as soon as they open their phone, they're like, what the fuck? So it's like a double, like, did Matt just leave? What the hell's going on? Like, you know, Cotton Eye Joe killed David. So what's happening? So even the audience is a little confused at this point.
Well, I think that's perfect. Like, let's kind of keep it on their toes. And then at some point, let's not forget to do this. At some point, whoever is surviving at the time needs to be like, let's get the fuck out of here. And they go run for the cars. They get to the fence and they're like, dude, like, where's David's car? Like, Matt left, but like, where's David's car? Like, his car is gone too. Because again, kind of driving home the point that, you know, Cotton Eye Joe is, you know, hiding the evidence. So we saw him drive off in Matt's car, but then everyone scared.
Go ahead. I thought they were all in one car.
Oh, I thought we had said that they were in two cars. Either way,
I thought they were all in one. So, because, yeah, I just figured, you know, they're teenagers. They would all pile into, like, David's got the car. Everyone has to ride with David, that type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, either way, it's fine. But, you know, if it was two cars, like, we got to get rid of the other one. But, yeah, it makes sense. Right. Let's just keep it simple. One car and it's gone. Yeah, so that's perfectly fine. Okay, so we got David off the game board. We saw Matt, or we heard Matt scream, and then he's gone. We're going to find out what happened to him later. And so Rose now is the one. Rose and Drew are together, and Monica and Tanya are together. But so we got to cut back and find out what Rose and Drew. Did they catch up to Monica and Tanya? Did I forget that?
I think Rose and Drew, like, they should catch up with Monica and Tanya. When the ghost bus goes flying by Monica and Tanya, they jump out of the way. They're like, holy shit. And then, like, they're kind of like laying on the side of the road, like, freaked out because the car just, like, disappeared in front of them. And then have Rose and Drew come running up, be like, are you guys okay? What was, is there a car in here? Like, have them all kind of freaking out. And then maybe at this point have Monica say something like, guys, I don't think we should be here. Like, I changed my mind. I want to go home. Like, I don't want to be here. Like, and that's when they could see, like, somebody going toward the gate and think, you know, it's Matt. And see the car, the headlights in the parking lot turn on and drive away, and then be like, dude, where the fuck is he going? Like, what's going on? And then, yeah, they do the cell phone thing where they try to call him, and then all their phones play the same thing simultaneously. They all freak out. Like, what the fuck's going on here? So now we've established that they are trapped in this place. Their car is gone. They can't call for help because none of their phones are working properly and playing ghost music. So at this point, maybe, Cotton Eye Joe is, we don't know where he is because he took out Matt. He did something with him. So we need to have more Cotton Eye Joe fun. So I don't know how we want to do this. If we want to have them try to get out and have him, like, approach them, so like kind of scare them away from the entrance, because remember, he was going to hide the car, so he'd be coming back in toward the front. So yeah, let's have them be like, you know, like, fuck it, we got to get out of here, like, let's fucking hitchhike if we have to, and have them running toward the front gate, like where they came in, and when they get there, just have this guy standing there staring at him, be like, who the fuck is this? And then have him just pull out a knife and smile at him and do the, like, shh, and raise it and come, like, just rush them and have them scatter, like, fuck, you know.
Okay, yeah, I like that, let's just have him come on the screen or come on the scene, but let me adjust that a little bit, if you don't mind.
Go for it.
Let's not forget that they don't know where David is, right? They think Matt drove away. They don't know where David is. So let's have them be like, okay, let's get the fuck out of here. But of course, somebody has got to be like, oh, like, where the fuck is David? Like they just now realize that he's not there with them, you know, and they're like, ah, fuck, like, last time I saw him, you know, he was over by the, you know, whatever, by the crime scene. So, let's get David and we'll get out of here. And so they run back in the direction they came from. And instead of going toward the gate, they're going back over toward the funhouse or whatever it is, like, where they were kind of hanging out. And they're kind of looking around, like, calling, David, where are you? We gotta get the fuck out of here. David, like, where the fuck, man? Like, where'd you go? You hiding somewhere? Like, this isn't funny, you know, that kind of thing. So they're not really split up, but they're just kind of, like, ranging around this, like, small area, kind of calling, David, where are you? We got to get out of here. Drew is the one who's, like, realizing what's happening. Is just like, you know what? Like, guys, we got to go. Like, forget him. Like, we got to go, you know? He's just ready to cut ties. And, of course, you know, the girls are like, what the fuck, dude? No, absolutely not. We got to find David. And so at this point, I'm not sure who we want to kill next. Like, let's just, if it's Rose, but, like, what we'll do is we'll have, you know, Rose, who's like, David, where are you? You know, she, like, you know, turns a corner and there's in the doorway, and she sees, like, this scary guy, and she's just like, I don't know what she says to the other group. Maybe she's just like, guys, like, who the fuck is this? Same thing, like, just like you said, instead of at the gate, he's, like, in this doorway, and he pulls out a knife and is like, shh. And then he, like, swipes at Rose, who's kind of close to him. They scream and run, but, like, they're in a panic run, and or maybe he's, like, between Rose and the rest of them, so she's kind of cut off running in a different direction. The point is, like, they're going to try to leave. He's going to, like, Rose is cut off from the group, and so Actually, hang on a second. I'm seeing the problem in my idea. I was trying to separate one of them from the rest, but of course, why don't the rest of them just leave, right? So maybe it's just that, like, they don't want to, like, leave their friends behind, just like they were following David. Like, they see this creepy guy come out, you know, swing a knife. Rose takes off. Drew's like, I'm getting the fuck out of here. Like, I'll hitchhike if I need to. He starts, like, walking toward the gate. Maybe Tanya and Monica are like, dude, what the fuck? Like, we can't just leave Rose. Like, who the fuck is that guy? You know, something along those lines of, like, they're going to talk themselves into staying to, like, you know, go rescue Rose. But, you know, they don't know who this fucking dude is. They don't know what – they don't really know what the danger is yet. They just think he's a creepy guy.
Well, do we want to play that, or do we want to just, like, up the ante immediately and be like, there's a killer – they're being hunted, because we're about, I would say, about a halfway point in the movie at this point. So I like where you're going with this, but what if we do something along these lines where we have them go looking for David? Like, you know, Drew is freaking out, being like, we got to go, guys. Like, we got to fucking leave. You know, I'll fucking hitchhike if I have to. This is, something's going on here. I don't want to be here. You know, he suddenly went from fascinated to he's scared. He wants out. They're walking around. They get over to the funhouse. And, you know, like, where they saw David walk off to. So they're like, well, we got to at least get David. Like, Matt took the fucking car, you know, but we got to get David, you know, because, like, Matt being the tallest of the bunch, like, you know, they mistook Cotton Eye Joe for David. Because, again, like you said, it's dusk. It's hard to see, or twilight. Yep. It's hard to see. So they just assumed it was him. So they go running around. Maybe they do find David. Like, yeah, you know what? Fuck it. Let's have them find David's corpse. So they go in into the funhouse and they see David's corpse laying there and freak the fuck out, understandably so, because now they just found one of their friends dead. And have, you know, maybe, like, they scatter, and this is where, like, Rose could, like, see Cotton Eye Joe and he could do the whole thing and, like, go to slash at her. Maybe he cuts her arm. Like, maybe he actually hits her. And she's like, what the fuck? And, like, runs off. And, like, the kids are scattering. We could have Drew, like, run for the gate. Like, he's getting the fuck out of there. Like, fuck everybody else. Have them even yelling for him. Like, Drew, where are you going? He's like, I'm fucking getting out of here. And as he's running toward the gate, we could have the ghost bus drive by and, like, startle the fuck out of him. Like, he can't get out because it's going to hit him if he does. That type of thing. Like, so we have them trapped and we know there's a killer. Like, everyone, like, everything is on the table.
I think this is great. Yeah, I think this is a good way to do it. You know, we floundered for a second, but this is perfect. So they go back to find David. They do find David at the funhouse. They're not exactly by the gate, not close enough where it'd be an easy escape. They find David. They freak out. They turn. They see Cotton Eye Joe standing there. Monica, Tanya, and Drew just run. Rose is frozen in fright for, like, a second, long enough for him to do his whole shh thing and, like, pull out his knife, you know, and slash at her. Like, yeah, again, cuts her arm. She's going to run. And then we see David, like, you know, like you said, to your point, he's running to the gate. The ghost bus, like, scares him, like it's going to round him up, you know, like, no, you can't leave, right?
Right.
Scare him just long enough till maybe, he, you know, he gets startled, he falls on the ground, you know, he's breathing heavy, eyes wide for a second, and like, what the fuck? And then by the time he gets up to, like, you know, figure out, like, what to do next, you know, he stands up, he turns slightly, and there's Cotton Eye Joe right there, and just, like, you know, knife in the gut. You know, like he slashed at Rose, but then he came after David because, you know, he's not an idiot. Yeah, Drew. That's yep. Right. Yeah, he comes after Drew because he's not an idiot. He's going to go for the guy who's about to escape. Like, stop him. You know, mm-hmm. Who knows if Cotton Eye Joe saw the bus? Maybe he did. I don't know. You know, but that doesn't matter. Like, he gets Drew in the gut, and then let's cut back to, you know, Rose, who's got, you know, her arm is bleeding. Maybe she sees Cotton Eye Joe just, you know, stabbing Drew over and over and over again, you know, and then start carving on him. And she's like, she just throws up and is, like, stumbling around, like, trying to call for Monica and Tanya, like, help, who, of course, were scared and, like, scattered, you know, and her own arm is bleeding. So she's just, like, panicking. She's gonna freeze. We could even cut over to Monica and Tanya and have one of them stop and realize, like, what the fuck, like, we can't just leave Rose and, like, Drew, like, what's going on, you know? And maybe, you know, maybe because I don't want them to be, like, you know, just completely abandon their friends, you know, even though,
right,
they're scared,
right?
Right. So have them kind of stop, just long enough to be like, okay, so they're going to stick around. But yeah, we could cut back to Rose and, you know, maybe, I don't know if we want to do this like in quick succession or not, but it's kind of creepy if we saw Cotton Eye Joe just, you know, walking up to her just real slow and confident, you know, like a Jason Voorhees walk while she's trying to run away, but she's, you know, all the blood's rushing out of her head. She's seeing spots, getting dizzy, not because, you know, she's bleeding that badly, but obviously because of the trauma, and she's so freaked out by everything. Hell, maybe she could just black out as Cotton Eye Joe is like stalking up to her, you know, black out and fall. You know, we go to black, cut back to Monica and Tanya, and then, you know, we can find out what happens to Rose.
Right. Okay. I love it. So yeah, exactly what you said. The scene I'm picturing is like, you know, when the Tanya and Monica like run off and kind of accidentally leave Rose because they panic run. And Rose is, to your point, like she's very squeamish around blood. She's cut herself. Maybe like looking down at her own blood, she's getting woozy. Like she's kind of like, oh God, oh no, 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 no. And she's like walking her like, don't look at it, don't look at it. And then she sees Cotton Eye Joe stabbing the fuck out of Drew, like you said. And I love this idea of like him in silhouette, just like carving. And we just see like we hear the squelching and blood splatter and all that. And then she's just like, oh my God, Drew, like what the fuck? And then have like we see all the blood like dripping off in, again, in silhouette, like dripping off of Cotton Eye Joe because he's like cutting through arteries and shit. He just takes one hand and like throws back this like wet with blood long hair that was kind of hanging in his face, just like flicks it back over his head and stands up and like takes this like, you know, just like standing above his corpse, takes this deep intake of breath and like looks over at her and then just starts walking right toward her. Just like you said, like just like Jason, and have her pen like, oh my God, oh my God, what the fuck? And then, yeah, again, pass the fuck out. Like she's seeing spots. We see her point of view where it's like she's getting fady, passes the fuck out, cut to black. Like he's, I love that visual of him standing up calmly and then looking over at her. So yeah, we'll cut to Monica and Tanya, you know, like, where's Rose? Be like, I thought she was right behind us. Be like, oh shit, like we lost Rose. Like have them freaking out. And then they're gonna have to go and look for her. So now we're gonna see Drew's corpse laying there, heart cut out of his chest, slashed to fuck, and Rose is missing. So now it's like they're missing Matt and they're missing Rose, and they got to find him.
Okay. So I just had this really ridiculous idea, and like, you tell me the level of ridiculousness we want to settle on. Okay.
Okay.
So we have two people left. We've had Cotton Eye Joe kill everybody, and we like again. Let's not forget that Mr. Six's ghost is here. We've seen the bus a couple times. We heard the creepy music, but we're also in an amusement park. And so far, all of the deaths have just been from like a big knife.
All slashy.
I can't say that phrase without saying big knife. Anyway, so let's, I don't know which carnival ride it is or which one of the amusement park rides, but let's incorporate a ride and I'm going to tell you the ridiculous thing in a second because it's going to lead up to the ride. So help me to like figure this out. The idea, what I'm saying is I want to have, it's got to be Tanya, right? If Monica is our final girl, like they're cornered by Cotton Eye Joe and don't really have anywhere to run except very much like, and again, I think it was Tina from the first one, like getting on the ride because there's nowhere else to go, right? And with
right.
Again, I think it was Tina who like gets on the roller coaster and gets stuck on it and is like, you know, tortured on the roller coaster. Let's have some, they get in, I don't know if it's the Ferris wheel or tilt-a-roll, they get in something and, or hell, it could even be the teacups. And then like the ride turns on and like it starts going faster and faster and faster. And then even Cotton Eye Joe is going to be freaked out by it. Okay. So I'm kind of going out of order because I had two thoughts at the same time. So let's have, before we do that, let's have Tanya and Monica, again, to your point, they want to go back and find out what happened to Rose. As they're walking back, you know, hesitantly trying and maybe trying to stay out of easy eye line, they see Cotton Eye Joe walking towards them. And again, this is where you tell me the level of ridiculousness. So before they run or get cornered by him, they see him coming and he just cut out the hearts of at least three people that we know, maybe four if you count Matt. So what I'm thinking is he's just juggling hearts.
Right.
Like he's got three, four hearts and he's literally just juggling them.
But, nice. please.
But he's like deadpan staring him right in the eyes, not looking at his hands, not looking at the hearts. But he's got bloody hearts just like, you know, making that weird squelching noise as he's juggling them. So, again, if you don't want to go that, if you don't go that silly, we can just have him like holding them, you know. But like, I just thought it would be so silly if he's just, he's having such a good time, but he's just juggling his trophies.
Well, I actually do really like that. But keep in mind, we don't know what happened to Rose yet. We haven't found her.
Okay.
Because the screen just went to black. And we don't, like, we know Matt's dead, but the audience doesn't know Matt's dead. So he would have, like, we saw him take out David and Drew's hearts. So, like, we know for a fact he has two of them. So, yeah. So let's have the thing, like, I kind of like this idea. Let's have them, instead of hiding on a ride just yet, because I want to come back to that, have them, like, duck down behind one of the carnival games, right? And like, they're freaking out, like, oh my God, who, you're like, who is that guy? Like, maybe they, oh, okay, well, let me backtrack. I'm sorry. So we cut to black. Monica and Tanya don't know where Rose is. They backtrack, and maybe they see a shadowy figure walking up the park, like by all the carnival games, just whistling. And of course he's going to be whistling Cotton Eye Joe.
Yes.
You know, so he's whistling along, and they duck down behind one, like maybe it's like the ring toss or whatever. And they're like ducking down. They're kind of watching, and he's walking by, and we see that he's like, he's playing with something. He's just kind of throwing it up in the air and catching it. And it's making that like wet squelching. And every time he catches it, like something hits the ground, like water hits the ground. You know, it's like a wet sound. Like, what the fuck? And like, he gets closer and he's kind of looking around. And again, we're still seeing him mostly in shadow. Looks around and then looks right at them, smiles, and fucking hucks the heart out. Just like, because they're in one of the carnival games. And then there's like, ah. And so, no, it would be the baseball, the knock over the bottles. Yes. So he fucking hucks awesome. The heart of their friend. And again, they fucking scatter. So now we split up Tanya and Monica. So they run in two different directions. And maybe this is the first time we see Cotton Eye Joe, like, show any kind of, like, energy outside of just, you know, slowly killing. Like, Tanya goes running in one direction, Monica goes running in the other, and he just kind of cracks his neck and runs like full fucking bore at Tanya, you know, and we see him like he's almost on top of her, you know, and have her like, I don't know if we want to have her get in. Yeah, you know what? Fuck it. I want her to get away. So like she runs into maybe like the little like restrooms that are always around amusement parks. Like mm-hmm. She runs in and she pulls the door closed and he like bangs into it. And he's like hitting it on the other side. And then he's like fucking with her. He's dragging the knife across it, like whistling his little tune. And she's in there just like crying, just like freaking out. You know, so we don't know what's going to happen to her. Meanwhile, cut over to Monica trying to find her way out, like trying to escape from this fucking nightmare that she's trapped in. And maybe she gets like, you know, she goes over to the front gate again, like tries to get out. I want to find Matt's body. And I'm thinking like, what kind of ridiculous place could we find him in? And the thing that keeps coming to mind is like, he's just laying dead, like standing dead in the ticket taker booth. Just like, like just yeah. Mouth agape, like, you know, maybe his phone is set up recording him. Like,
yes. Yeah, that'd be perfect. Okay. So a couple of things are coming to me, right? Okay. So this is what I'm thinking. To your point, Tanya is like in the bathroom trying to hide. Cotton Eye Joe is like fucking with her. And by the way, I love the idea of him just out of nowhere, just running full speed. Like that's fucking creepy as shit, right? Because you expect, right? You know, movie serial killers, they always walk slow. You know, they casually follow you around and somehow they're always right there. But no, he's just going to fucking run at you like the Dawn of the Dead remake zombies, you know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, I like that. So let's have Monica, like she kind of sees what's going on, but she's freaking out trying to hide. And I don't want to go so far as to have like the ride become dangerous, but let's have her. Yeah. Like she backs up to a point where, you know, she's near the, say the Ferris wheel. And yeah, there's like, you see, like I said, there's the ticket taker thing and she's kind of trying to figure out like, what do I do? You know, how do I save Tanya? Like, I don't know what to do. She's looking around. She sees fucking Matt, like in the ticket taker booth for the Ferris wheel, like, you know, taking selfies of his dead self, you know, enough where she screams, takes a step back, falls into one of the gondolas for the Ferris wheel and the shit turns on. Right.
Oh,
so,
okay.
Right. And so it turns, she's now she's even more freaked out. And maybe Cotton Eye Joe turns and looks, like he stops like scratching at the door of the bathroom. He turns and looks like, what the fuck? And the Ferris wheel's going up. And then you start seeing like more lights are coming on. Like we heard in the last episode, yes. I was like, the lights went off. We heard that like ka-chunk, ka-chunk. Now it's like the lights are starting to turn on. You're hearing the music, the little like calliope music play like distantly, you know, softly. Mm-hmm. And everyone's kind of freaking out who's still alive. And at some point, you're going to see I'm not sure exactly how this plays out, so help me out here. But I want the Ferris wheel to stop while Monica is high up just to give her to give the opportunity where she has to kind of decide, like, OK, I really stop being the victim. I need to help Tanya. So and she's freaked out. So she's going to climb out of this Ferris wheel. And it adds a little bit of extra tension of her trying to climb down, you know, maybe not from the very, very tippy top, you know, but she's going to try to climb down out of it while, you know, Cotton Eye Joe is menacing Tanya. And now we can kind of ease back into, like, you know, how does Mr. Six come back into play?
You know what? I love where you're going with this, but same concept. Just everything you said. Lights are on. She's stuck at the top. I like her being at the tippy top. But the lights in the park have all come on, so she has a good vantage point and she can see. Like she sees freaking Cotton Eye Joe standing in front of that restroom, but like looking up at her because now the lights are all on. Mm-hmm. He can see her. She can see him. And we just see him, like, grin at her, and he just wipes the blood from his knife and starts walking toward the Ferris wheel. Nice. So she's like, fuck, I gotta get down, you know, so she starts climbing and trying to get down. But, and again, of course, Cotton Eye Joe is gonna get to the booth before she can climb down, so maybe he makes the Ferris wheel go in motion again, so she's, like, hanging on for dear life as the thing is moving around, and then he turns it and makes it go in reverse, so she's, like, screaming for help, trying to get out of there, you know, he's toying with her, having fun. Now, we can cut back to Tanya, like, she hears her friend screaming, she doesn't hear the scratching anymore, and she's like, okay, I gotta go, opens the door, and, like, have her see, you know, Monica being terrorized by this fucking serial killer. So neither of these kids really know that there's a fucking ghost bus yet. So we have, you know, she's coming over, like, trying to figure out how do I stop this killer from killing my friend? And then we need to have, like, a big Mr. Six reveal here. We got to have him come in.
And I'm sorry if I'm interrupting you, but
no, go for it.
Okay, so no, this is perfect, right? Exactly. So I love what you said, right? Make this real creepy, tense moment where Cotton Eye Joe is like turning the Ferris wheel on, and then it stops, and Monica tries to climb out, and then he turns it on again, and then it stops. It's almost like he's fighting with it, like he wants to turn it on and it won't stay on. You know what I mean? Again, this whole idea of like Mr. Six is like jealous of like the victims, you know, like so okay, yeah, to your point, we cut back to Tanya. She creeps out of the bathroom. Maybe she grabs something from the bathroom that is going to be a weapon, like a broken piece of mirror or, you know, something, right? Or maybe there was like an old broom in there, whatever. So she's got a little bit of a weapon. She's shaking, you know, walking kind of like crouched over, trying to like sneak up behind, you know, Cotton Eye Joe. She's getting closer. And then it's just da-na-da-da-da-da-na, and the fucking bus comes out, and it's like the fucking bus that hits Regina George in Mean Girls and just wipes out Tanya and just like splatters her all over the ground. Or like that scene from Devil's Rejects when that chick just like, yep, pops.
the one I always think of is the end of Final Destination, where the chick gets hit with the – or not the end, but like the middle of Final Destination where the chick gets hit by the bus. And the scene in Bride of Chucky where the guy like jumps out of the fucking car on the 190. He's just like, oh my God, and then gets hit by the Mack truck and it fucking explodes.
Yes, exactly. Like just out of nowhere, just this horrible, gory explosion like from the roller coaster from the first one, right? And you're like, you would not expect it out of nowhere, because even when we saw the ghost bus before, it was just a ghost and it like drove past them or through them or whatever. Now it's like solid. Fucking pops are like a pimple. Cotton Eye Joe is going to turn startled. Like now, holy shit, like, what the fuck just happened? He's scared. Like, what was that? You know, like,
yep.
He didn't really see it necessarily, like, fully, because he was turned looking at Monica. But, you know, maybe he just got a glimpse of it after it, like, faded away. But, like, he definitely sees Tanya smeared all over the ground and is just like, holy shit, you know? So he stops messing with Monica, and now he's, like, on the edge, right? He's got his knife, and he's going to kind of be walking over to where, like, Tanya was, and he's looking around, like, who the fuck is here? What was that? What's going on? Now he feels like he's the victim.
Wait, before, you know what? I hate to jump ahead like this, but I feel like we're closing in on the end of the story anyway, so, like, let's just fucking do this. So yeah, like you said, Mr. Six and the ghost bus comes out, fucking smears Tanya on the fucking pavement. You know, she's just a red smear at this point. Cotton Eye Joe turns, like, what the fuck? Like, he doesn't say anything. He just looks scared, like you said. And we see the bus, like, we see it from behind, like, just idling after it had just, like, run over Tanya. And we do the camera pan around where we pan around the bus. We kind of see that it's, like, it's ghostly looking. Like, there's maybe, like, that blue haze coming off of it. We pan around to the front. We see all the guts and gore dripping off of it, like we've seen multiple times in the first one, the 666. And we pan around to the door, and we're, like, at the bottom step on the door, and we just see Mr. Six's, like, boot step out, kind of like we saw with Cotton Eye Joe, and have him walk out. We'll do the camera pan around to, like, this ghostly figure, and then we see that corpsely grin from the first movie.
Nice.
And he just grins at Cotton Eye Joe. So now we're going to have our fucking Frankenstein versus Wolfman, Freddy versus Jason, fucking Godzilla versus Kong moment.
Yeah, no, I love this. So we left Monica kind of, like, half climbed out of the Ferris wheel, right? So
like dangling.
Yeah, so let's leave her there for a second. Yeah, and I don't know what your vision is for this fight, but, like, I'm thinking you have a real, like, a human serial killer, and then you have, like, a ghost. And
yep.
It's going to be sort of a weird Freddy versus Jason thing, I think, where, like, they're going to go start slashing at each other. It would be funny if Cotton Eye Joe is just like, fuck this guy, and goes to stab him, and his arm goes straight through. And
yep.
Mr. Six just, like, smiles at him, and then he... I don't know if he has a weapon or whatever, but, like, he's got to hurt Cotton Eye Joe and be like, haha, you can't hurt me, but I can hurt you.
That's exactly what I was picturing. So we do Mr. Six, like, grinning at him. Cotton Eye Joe, you know, he ain't afraid of shit. So he starts coming out, like, he ain't afraid of no ghosts, goes to stab him. And yeah, to your point, his arm goes through him, and have Mr. Six just smile and fucking backhand him with the tire iron that he killed a couple people with.
Yes. That's a great one.
And have Cotton Eye Joe, like, fall back and be like, what the fuck? Like, kind of looking, like, now he looks scared. And he starts, like, scrambling backward as Mr. Six comes at him with the tire iron, fucking stabs him in one leg. You know, we see it, like, we hear this, like, crunching break, like, as it breaks through the bone. He starts screaming, stabs through the other leg. He starts screaming. And maybe he looks down at his one good eye and pulls it out of his fucking head.
Ah.
Just, like, just yanks it out. And then literally does the thing. He, like, smiles, like, again, I'm picturing that corpse grin where the lips don't quite shut, so, like, the teeth are kind of exposed. Have him pull up a ghostly, bony, drippy finger and go, shh, like, real close at the camera. And then have him look up at Monica and smile, like, almost like you're next. And then stab him with the tire iron and start dragging him toward the lake. And we see the bus, like, automatically turn and start going with him toward the fucking lake. And now she's scrambling down, kind of like the Freddy versus Jason thing. Well, you know, plus, you know, just for people listening, every versus in horror movie ends in water. They always go into the water. That's why I'm doing this. So he drags him into the lake, and we see, like, you know, Cotton Eye Joe's kind of flailing around, like, he's missing an eye, he's beat to shit, but he ain't dead yet. And he just gets dragged into the, what we see all this blood, like, start burbling up into the water. The ghost bus does what you said before, like, where it goes in the water with no splash, nothing. It doesn't disturb the water at all. You know, Monica gets down off the Ferris wheel and fucking runs, like, just runs for the fucking gate. And, like, she's freaking out. You know, her friends are dead. She just runs out of that. And that's, like, you know, she gets away. Like, we actually do have a final girl that escapes. And then, but I want to have, like, you know, after, like, the dust has settled, you know, and maybe she, like, runs out to the throughway, you know, and, like, covered in blood, like, freaking out, gets picked up, and we're doing the end credits thing where it's like credits cut to her getting in the car, and, you know, back to the credits, you know, cut back to her being like, I need help. I need the police. Like, and be like, oh shit, we're going to get you help, girly. And like driving away. And then we're going to cut back to the park and zoom in on the lake. And we just see the red, like, gore all in the lake. And then we just see like a hand slowly reach up out of the water and cut to black.
Oh, fuck yeah. That's awesome.
So, because here's the question. Is it a trilogy?
Yeah, no, I think it needs to be. I think, okay, before we open up that can of worms, real quick, just logistically, I don't want to forget that we had Cotton Eye Joe, like, hide the car, but we never really explained it, right? Everyone thought that Matt left, so... When Tanya escapes, either
Monica,
she stumbles across the car and like crashed into like, you know, the ravine near the lake and realizes, okay, fuck yeah, that's what happened. Like, Matt didn't really leave. Like, you know, Cotton Eye Joe hid the car like by, you know, driving it into this ravine. Or when she runs out, there's already a cop who's like at the car, like looking at this car in the ravine, and sees her running up screaming, like, and that's kind of how she gets rescued, because somebody was already out there, like, perfect, investigating this, like, you know, somebody heard the car crash into the woods and like called the cop, you know. That might not work because, of course, you know, he would be suspicious of the like lights in the amusement park. So yeah, maybe she just finds the car while she's trying to run away, but then the cop is there because he's like, I saw the lights in the music, and what the fuck's going on? You fucking kids out here playing pranks, and holy shit, what happened to you, Missy? You know, that kind of a thing.
You know what? You just gave me an idea. Fuck it. No one survives. I love this. Okay. So yes, exactly what you said. Like, she runs out of the park. We see there are already cops there. Like, there are cops that, like, you know, maybe they're by the, you know, the side, like that little utility road that kind of like veers off the parking lot. They're there with the car, and they're like, whoa, 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 what are you doing in here? No one's supposed to be in here. But they see she's covered in blood, you know, because the amusement park lights were all on. So of course it's going to draw attention. So they send several cops there to like figure out what the fuck's going on, you know, and then this blood covered girl comes running out, and they're like, whoa, you're not supposed to be here. What's going on? Why are you here? All that. And then again, we're going to have the fucking ghost bus run everybody down, like murdering everybody. And then we do the mid-credit stinger of the hand rising up out of the water.
Okay. Yeah, this is perfect. Yeah. So I love this. Monica runs out of the park while Mr. Six is like, you know, dragging Cotton Eye Joe like into the water. She runs out of the park. Let's have that. There's cops who are like driving up. They screech to a halt, like, say, two cop cars. They screech to a halt, like, kind of next to each other on the road. They jump out. One guy's got his hand on his gun, and he's like, yo, whoa, 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 like, what are you doing? Then realizes that she's a victim and not a potential, you know, like, perpetrator or something, you know, somebody who had broken into an amusement park, which is what they were out there investigating. And she starts screaming, and she's getting kind of hysterical. We could just have, an easy line of dialogue, like, what are you doing out here? Like, was that your car in the ravine? Like, what happened? Was there an accident? You know, something simple like that. And then to your point, you just hear the music, you know, blare on, and the fucking Vengabus comes up from like behind the cop cars and bowls through them like bowling pins, and the cars and the cops and fucking everybody go crazy, right? You see Monica like extreme close up, the headlights are on her face, her eyes are wide open screaming, just ah, and then black, like she get, you know, like,
yes,
we don't necessarily see her get splattered, but like, boom, that's the end of it. Fade to black, you know, the music rolls, that creepy slow version of the Vengabus, maybe with like a weird Cotton Eye Joe remix, you know, and then we do the mid-credit stinger.
Yes. Okay, just back up one sec where we had the bowling pin thing you said, because you got to go big for the sequel. You have when he crashes into the cars, like they go flying out of the way and fucking explode. Like it's just like boom, boom. And like you just see cops flying on fire, and then like Monica, to your point, like fall backward and start like backing up, panicking like no. And then like the bus is bearing down on her. Hit, you know, cut to black, hear the music, credits roll, people cheer, then mid-credit stinger, you know, the hand up out of the water, you know, and maybe like a, you know, the end question mark, you know, like.
Yeah, exactly. I love it.
Now the question is, if there is a part three, what song is going to be the impetus for this one?
Oh, God. Like. We need another like ridiculous like 90s one hit wonder like party jam.
God, no. The first thing that came to mind. I don't know if I could do this. I don't know if it's possible. But the first thing I thought of was fucking Crazy Frog. And I was like, oh, God.
No, dude. Mambo number 5, motherfucker.
Lou Bega.
Oh, I get knocked down, but I get up again. Fucking Chumbawamba.
Dude, because Cotton Eye Joe got knocked down, but he's getting up again.
Dude, I think that might be it. I think we might have to do fucking Chumbawamba.
I will say the fucked up thing is after working on the pitch for this, every song that I've been listening to, I've been hearing in a way where it's like, I wonder if that could be turned into a horror story. And then I started thinking, like, that would be a really funny, like, ongoing segment for this show. It'd be like, you know, Mike's Murderous Melodies or something.
Right.
Because I had my Spotify playlist on. It was a short playlist. So it was only like 2 hours. And I had it playing at work last night. And then, you know how Spotify, it'll do, like, other suggestions, and it'll just start playing random songs? Well, it started playing Take On Me by Aha, and I started imagining, like, what if that, like, I was picturing the video, and I'm like, what if that was, like, a horror movie where you were being sucked into a story and couldn't escape? Like, you were trapped in this fictitious world where someone was, like, trying to kill you. I'm like, oh, fuck, you could do this with a lot of songs. Like,
yeah, exactly. Oh, fuck yeah, dude. That's creepy as hell. Oh, man. I love it. I love it. I'm sorry. I can't help but thinking about, like, fucking Tub Thumping and, like, there's so many possibilities for that fucking song. Like, I think we're going to have to revisit this, like, next summer. This might have to be, like, an annual thing for, like, the summertime, like, drive-in double feature, you know?
I love it. You know, I knew I was going to have a blast with this episode, but it came together in ways I did not expect it to, and I fucking love it. Like, this was so much fun.
Fuck yeah, yeah, definitely, yeah. We definitely hit that little bit of, like, a fumble in the middle that we do sometimes, but we totally recovered the ball, and yeah, I love where this ended, because I really didn't know where it was going. I loved, like, the play-by-play, blow-by-blow of Cotton Eye Joe just, like, murdering people and, like, developing him as a character. I knew the Vengabus was going to come back, and I wanted to have some kind of a, you know, Freddy versus Jason, you know, Dracula versus Wolfman, like, showdown, like we said, but I didn't know, like, where we were going. I was kind of like, yeah, like, there's a new killer and then the old killer kills the new killer, but, like, what else do you do? And I really like where we ended up with it, because what makes it fun is that we have so many, like, kind of surprising deaths, like, you know, when Tanya just gets smeared, you know.
and you know, the funny thing is that death does not get old, because every time I've seen it in a horror movie, it's both startling and hilarious every time. You know, it's just like, oh, shit. Oh, my God. Like, you start and you, like, laugh uncomfortably every time someone just gets turned into a red smear on the pavement. But it's like the only thing I knew about the end that I wanted was I was like, OK, obviously Mr. Six is going to kill Cotton Eye Joe because Mr. Six is an undead, like, fucking specter. And, you know, and Cotton Eye Joe is human. But I knew that they had to go into the lake because I'm like, again, every versus movie, there's some kind of water that's like, you know, the original Kong versus Godzilla, they fall into the ocean. The gargantuan movies, they fall into the ocean. You know, Wolfman versus Frankenstein, they get swept away in when the dam breaks and the water washes them down river. You know, Freddy versus Jason, they end up in Crystal Lake. Like, it's always water. They always, and we never, it's never 100% clear. Did they both die? Did they both live? Like, did, you know, what's going on? And I think that that's fucking hilarious that in that grand tradition, we did that with this fucking ridiculous concept.
Yeah. I think it's fucking amazing. And I'm even more excited just from, like, the energy of this, the creative energy. I'm so excited about doing the next follow-up, which will be part two of, you know, the original two-parter was Hot Garbage, where we had, like, a possessed dumpster killing people and, like, you know, giving gifts to the person who was, like, taking care of it, I guess, you know, feeding it victims. And so now we're going to do a follow-up to Hot Garbage next time. So definitely come back for the second part of what I'm now just going to call the summertime drive-in double feature, and we will do the follow-up to Hot Garbage.
I can't fucking wait, like, because again, like, out of our original concepts, Hot Garbage and the Vengabus of Death are probably my favorites. Like, I had a lot of fun with Skin Deep and with oh my god, why can't I think of the dog, the
Never Kill the Dog.
Thank you, Never Kill the Dog. I wanted to say The Dog Never Dies, but I'm like, that's wrong. But yeah, like, I had a lot of fun with those and, like, Suffer the Children and all those other ones we did. Like, I had blasts doing all those. But something about, like, the ridiculous nature of, like, where these two stories came from. And because they're so insane, we can just do whatever the fuck we want with them. And they still work. So I'm so psyched to see what happens next time we record.
Me too. Absolutely. And I have a kernel of an idea. I don't really have it exactly nailed down, not nearly as much detail as, you know, you came up with that you were trying to resist, you know, but I do have an interesting concept. I mentioned part of it briefly on a previous episode when we were brainstorming a little bit, but I added some to it. So yeah, I definitely think that this will be fun. And in the grand tradition of dumb horror movie and like 80s and 90s movies tropes, this is going to be a prequel. We're doing a prequel to Hot Garbage.
Yes!
Absolutely.
I'm so excited because I remember you had mentioned that being a possibility, and mm-hmm. I ain't going to lie, like, I was kind of hoping you were going to do a prequel because I have some really stupid ideas for a prequel. I don't know if they'll fit, but if they do, it'll be funny.
I'm sure we'll make them fit. Yeah, it's going to be really fun. So, yeah, we're going to do a prequel, and, you know, hopefully maybe we'll find out, like, how that dumpster got there, what the whole deal was. But we'll find out. We'll see. We'll see if it's an origin story or not when we get there. But for now, thanks once again, everyone, for tuning in to the Raised by Rentals program. You can find us online at raisedbyrentals.com, at raisedbyrentals, on all the socials. Of course, you know that by now if you're listening to this, which is our 76th episode. Don't forget, we also belong to the Rad Pantheon, a super team up of podcasters, artists, musicians, a whole art collective of creative friends supporting each other and helping to spread the word about rad stuff. So if you like this show, definitely check out all of the other Rad Pantheon teammates, all the other shows and artists and music and all that cool stuff. Check it out, radpantheon.com. What about you, Mike? What do you got going on?
Well, right now, it's we're still doing Count Creepyhead Saturday Morning Monster Mash. Boogeyman's Closet, unfortunately, is still on hiatus. It's just been a very, very hectic time with work and commissions. But it will be coming back. I know it's been a long time, but we already have plans on the table. But you can check out, I'm all over social media, both Instagram, TikTok, posting artwork, you know, when I can. But definitely check out Rad Pantheon for all that.
All right. Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to the return of the Boogeyman's Closet. That should be fun. Hopefully that is counting down to happen pretty soon. But in the meantime, once again, thanks for tuning in to the Raised by Rentals program. If you had fun with us, visit us on the socials, drop us a line, leave us a comment, leave us a podcast rating, do all of that good stuff. But don't forget to let us know what you think we should improve next time. And with that, I'm Josh.
I'm Mike.
And we have to return some videotapes.
Do, 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 do,